Ladies and gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barndominium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure, and he just dives in!
Bradford.
All right. Greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Signarama Studios, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks, signarama.com, located in West Columbia. Gamecock owned, Gamecock operated. Served by Chicken Cock Bourbon and always built by the Barndominium Company. The Barndo Co is what they're called, where you can build your dream home in the Carolinas, Georgia, or in Tennessee. If you haven't seen some of the renderings, you should head to thebarndominiumco.com to find those. They are absolutely spectacular. So is Hale McGranahan, who is in place of J.C. Sherbert to lead us off. J.C. will be along in just a moment, wrapping up, or has already wrapped up, J.C. and Morgan this morning. Andy Staples was on with them. If you haven't had a chance to check that out, do it at 2:01. This afternoon, because we'll be off the air at 2 p.m. Also, 1 o'clock or 1:20 on our program, Grayson Greiner will jump in. The brand new reinvented Grayson Greiner. He's played the game at a high level, and now he's up in the broadcast booth at a high level as well. Looking forward to giving him some public compliments on how well he did last week for Gamecock baseball. Plenty of basketball to get to, but the football report is what will lead us off today with Hale. Hey, bud.
Hey, I want to make a public statement and a confession at the same time, I guess. I haven't been in tune with the show since I was on last week, so what's up with that mustache?
With you.
Like Walter White over here.
Oh, all right. So I'm not a very hirsute man, as you can tell. But this is the longest I've ever let my facial hair grow, because normally I find it extremely aggravating, but my wife said that she liked it, so I figured, okay, I'll give it a chance. And I've been actually kind of surprised that the mustache is like visible, because I'm a natural blonde as well, so you know, you can see it. But yeah, you know, I call it the dirty white boy look. It may not necessarily hang around for much longer, but yes, it's actually been a work in progress now. For this is 4 weeks worth of growth, folks. This is what you get after 4 weeks.
Oh wow! Okay,
yeah, man.
Your facial hair is worse than mine, and mine's not great. So
I can't, like, this whole beard trend. You could miss me with all that, because there's no way anything more than like three tiny individual hairs will grow on the side of my face.
Yeah, I can't do that cool guy look JB's got going either. So got part ways with it.
Yeah, it didn't take me long to grow my facial hair back. It happens, I'd say, pretty quickly. Phil, I wasn't gonna say anything about it yesterday, but I'm glad Hale did.
I'll break the ice. I don't care.
No, no, that's fine. That's fine. Yes, it is a different look. Yes, it is intentional. for what it's worth.
It's a conversation starter. There's no doubt about that.
That's right. Indeed. That's right. I've been kind of impressed with how thick the mustache came in. It's taken me, you know, 40 plus years to get it to even look like this. I won't say this good, but to look like this.
That Hale, the mustache with Mad Dog coincides with the purchase of a brand new 1987 brown Dodge van that is now parked in his driveway with free candy written on the side of it.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm not going there.
That's right. That's right.
Oh, man. Well, welcome aboard. I haven't even looked. I know I got it over the weekend. What's the media schedule this week? You got to get to the facility here in a little while, right?
Yeah, we've got Shane Beamer here at 12:30, I believe it is. The team practice this morning. But what opens media? So they're practicing right now, I guess. And we'll talk to Shane afterwards. And tomorrow we have players, I believe it is. And on Thursday, two or three coaches. I can't remember which ones. I'd have to look at my email. But that's the schedule. I don't think we have any practices we can go in and watch. And then they'll practice again on Saturday. The ladies' clinic is on Saturday as well. That's what it is for the week. That's the schedule. They practice Tuesday, Thursday, and most Saturdays. They didn't practice this past Saturday. Shane, as he said during his press conference last week, that everybody had the weekend off for Easter. So that's what it's looking like.
I'm sure he was probably down here, out there on Kiowa.
I saw a beach picture. It looked like they went to a Sunday service. So I'm guessing that's where it was, somewhere down there.
Yeah, probably down at his house out there. Well, maybe ask him about that today. Maybe sit right there in front of DC and interrupt the press conference with what he did on Easter. Who won the Easter egg hunt? You know, the important stuff that people.
How much ham did you eat? Are you a deviled eggs guy? Kind of like the Thanksgiving press conference, but for Easter, 3 days late. Or 2 days late. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll kind of give them some softballs like they do in the upstate. How about that? That's for another day too, Hale. All right. Well, we'll open this with an open book. What's the latest on spring practice? What have you uncovered since we last spoke last Tuesday?
Well, not a whole lot. I mean, like I said, they didn't have anything over the weekend. We had some assistant coaches last Thursday. I think the most interesting development was Markel Blackwell not doing his interview last Thursday for whatever reason. He tapped out of that one. So beyond that, it's been pretty quiet, honestly. Today's the first day they've practiced since Thursday morning. So haven't heard a whole lot. I certainly didn't try to bother anybody over the holiday weekend. I mean, I took some time off myself, so I'm kind of jumping back into it and real interested to hear kind of Shane's latest words on several obvious areas like quarterback and things like that, but I don't really have a whole lot of interesting things to say right now. Sorry.
No. It's okay. You know, Lamont Paris kind of echoed some of what we were seeing from Coach Beamer when he got to school. Remember, Hale, he would, and he still does it. It just hasn't been as frequent, probably because we're in the off season, but. Mm-hmm. Shane keeps receipts, and Lamont Paris obviously kept plenty of receipts with this basketball team throughout the year. He even talked to us about that on our program. Mm-hmm. But I'm always curious, not that it matters because it doesn't, but I'm always curious. You hear these coaches say, oh, you know, we don't pay attention to the outside noise. You know, all the lines, Haley, you've heard them all 1,000 times. But we're getting into list season. We were even talking about this yesterday, right, Phil? I think was it Mike or JC? Somebody brought up some quarterback ranking list or something. Athlon.
Yeah, it was part of the Love Chevy drive around the SEC yesterday with I think it was Athlon ranked the SEC quarterbacks 1-16.
Yeah, and they had – where did they have Lenoris? 12, 13?
15 is where
15. Hale, 15. Yes. Look at that.
Yeah. Another outfit had him at about 12 or 13. He's definitely between 12 and 15 on just about everyone. And I think it's kind of a a prove it ranking, you know, show me something.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. It is. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, those lists are largely based on what a guy has already done, who he was as a recruit, even for guys who haven't played or things like that. And Lenore was not the highest rated recruit, and he played a little bit last year. And they're probably person who made that list. It's very possible they don't even know anything about Lenore Sellers other than he's at University of South Carolina. So
that's you got to be kidding me. I thought all these guys were experts. Yeah. You know, I thought that, you know, Don Smith with Athlon Sports, who's located in Bismarck, North Dakota, surely knew what he was talking about when it came to ranking the SEC quarterbacks, right? But I am always curious to learn whether coaches use those things sometimes at practice. Hey, you see where you see they got you ranked as the 15th best quarterback. Does Shane ever talk about those things? Like, he's never mentioned anything like that to me, but just in offhand conversations, does he ever bring those things up to some of those guys?
He's aware. I think most people know that Shane's pretty in tune with what's being said and written about his program. I don't think he, you know, spends a ton of time on it, but he's got the nuts and bolts of it down pretty well. And whether people want to criticize that or not, that's just reality. So yeah, I've heard him talking about stuff that's out there in the past, and yeah, like I said, he knows it's out there, and he certainly understands that it's part of the deal, and I think he kind of embraces it in some way. And I think any college coach, pro coach, really any level, if they're looking for ways to motivate their team and there's stuff being said about them, that's a good place to start. I mean, just hearing Danny Hurley, some stuff he tries to get his team motivated for. They're beating everybody by 30, and he's still trying to dig up crap just to keep his guys motivated. So, yeah, Shane definitely is aware.
Yeah, it's funny, to again, because we hear it all year long from all these coaches. We don't pay attention. I just don't believe that, you know. Like, it's hard to believe that because it's so accessible. And a guy like Coach Beamer, who very aware of social media, he knows what's out there and what's being said. He'll respond from time to time, as we all well know.
Can I make one more point on this? Yeah, JB, I think it's probably almost more important that the coaches are aware, any coach is aware of what's being said and written and all that, because their players are definitely digesting it, and people that talk to their players and are in their players' ears. So, like, it's probably almost best to be aware of what's going on as opposed to just ignoring it and just getting totally blindsided maybe sometimes. So
that's an interesting point, right? Because it's kind of flipped on its head, because you had years past where, I mean, you'd have social media bans. Remember those? I don't think those exist. Yeah. Do those still exist? I don't even know if those exist anymore.
I know Clemson was kind of known for that. Their players, quote unquote, stayed off Twitter during the season, but I don't know if that's still a thing up there or not. I don't know. It's not around here.
Yeah, I'm not so sure. But you get a lot of these coaches now, like Coach Beamer, who embrace it, and they'll correct the narrative sometimes when it's wrong. As far as the on the field stuff goes, one of the things he continues to press when he steps up to the podium every Tuesday is the word competition and depth. Competition and depth. What have you learned about the competition and depth that we've got in spring of 24 versus 23, 22, and 21 under Coach Beamer?
Yeah, I mean, you can just look at the running back position, for example, and all the guys they've got there right now, and even like Rocket Sanders isn't practicing, but, you know, they've still got Oscar Attaway and Jawaan Howell, DJ Braswell, and they've got guys competing pretty legitimately for a spot, whereas last year, DeCarrion Joyner moved to running back, and if folks remember, like, he went start to finish till the season started from spring to, you know, September 1st or whatever that date was in Charlotte. He was a starting running back, and there was nothing changed. So I think that position is an example. Defensive end is another obvious one in my mind. Probably should start at quarterback, because clearly there's a different scenario going on this year compared to last year. So yeah, and there are several other positions like that other cornerback spot opposite of O'Donnell Fortune. That's up for grabs. All the wide receiver spots. I'm sure Nick Harbor, whenever he gets back into football, will have a pretty big say in things. And obviously, folks probably know by now they're going to try to get some other guys out of the portal here later this month. So either way, all those positions are up for grabs. There's a lot of competition there. The offensive line's somewhat settled, but really not, because wasn't the greatest year there, and they brought in a bunch of new guys from the portal and the high school level. So tons of spots up for grabs, and I think if you compare it to just last year, there's a lot of things to feel good about. And for me, especially going back to running back and defensive end in particular, where there are more good players are there. And more good players are competing to get on the field and make a difference.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I think it really is, like you talk about the transfer portal, which you cover the transfer portal every day, because even when it's closed, it's seemingly not closed. And you go back a year, like let's rewind this thing 365 days. We're having these same conversations, I'm sure, Hale, last April, about the different position groups. And we were specifically with running back, for instance, the majority of the conversation centered around DeCarrion Joyner and how he was changing his body to be a SEC guy, be an every down guy, maybe 15, 20 carries a game, all those type things, right? And now you fast forward 365 days, and you've got Oscar Attaway, who had an exceptional career at North Texas. Obviously, you know, Jawan Howell, a guy who we're learning a lot about this young man. I think we're understanding more and more that he's a pretty good football player, but the rest of the league. And like, if we mentioned the lists, right? Like if you're going to start ranking SEC running back rooms, and his name is going to come up, and there's going to be nothing more than that, because he came from South Carolina State. He's not a familiar name. He's not a guy who's really on anybody's radar. He'll have to prove that publicly. Now, I'm not talking about on our practice fields here in Columbia, but outside of that. You mentioned Rocket Sanders. Everybody knows the situation there. It's amazing what the portal giveth, the portal taketh away, and how it changes the narrative and changes the conversation. I mean, who was the most proven running back last year in April? Was it Juju?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Right? Isn't that crazy? That's crazy to think about. So you've got how many carries on this coming into this season between all these guys, like career-wise? 1,000 or more?
Yeah, I've looked at it. I've counted it up before. I can't remember off the top of my head, but it is a lot. Yeah.
It's a lot. So when you have depth, but then you have like real depth, like guys who've played football, I would have to think that just outside of their own position group, it's elevating other position groups as well, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, these guys are all interconnected. They know what's going on. They're all learning the same offense and all that type of stuff, but they have played football. Like, it's not like they're just new to the college game. So experience depth, I think, is something that is going to be really, really key as the spring goes on. And, of course, into the fall, hey, I'm really interested, because that matters. Obviously, the more you play, the better player you're going to be, generally speaking. And these guys have a lot of guys who played football.
Yeah, and sticking on that, you know, running back, look back at last year with Clint Morrison in the chat. I mean, they did try to – this coaching staff did try to add running backs from the portal last year. You know, they did get Mario Anderson. I mean, I guess he was the most experienced guy, but not at South Carolina, not as a returning player. And they tried to get Logan Diggs, who ended up at LSU and is back in the portal. Surprise, surprise.
Has he not found a place to go yet? Is he still?
I don't know if he has or not. Dylan Johnson, the guy who's at Washington and was awesome for them this season, they tried to get him, and there are several others. So it's not like they didn't just look at their group of guys they had last year and say, "All right, we're good. Let's see what happens." Like they tried, but they just weren't successful in most cases.
Diggs is going to Ole Miss.
Of course. Yeah, that's funny. But that position, I mean, to kind of tie in what you're saying, Like, imagine if Spencer Rattler had a reliable running game to help take some of the pressure off of him and what he had to do as a passer. For the offensive line, as much as we saw them struggle in a lot of areas, you know, if they're a little bit better at running back, maybe those struggles aren't as noticeable. Or, you know, you can help mask a lot of things when you've got really good running backs as opposed to average at best. And yeah, I think this team is much improved that way for sure.
I think that specifically the running back group, you talk about Mario Anderson, you don't have to go back very far to take an off the radar name, plug it into the conversation and prove how well it can work at this level. I mentioned Oscar Attaway, a guy coming from North Texas. It's not like he transferred in from LSU or Alabama or Arkansas, you know, like some big superstar that everybody was covering every year in the SEC. He's a guy coming from the Mean Green, mm-hmm. outstanding football player. But for the talking heads that cover a lot of college football, maybe not on their radar, Juwan Howell, same thing. And then all of a sudden they're really good football players. I mean, mm-hmm. Mario Anderson, nobody was talking about Mario Anderson. I think it was the North Carolina game because I was in Charlotte and he got like one carry. And I turned to the guy who I'm there with and I said, he's probably the best running back on the team. Just the most instinctual guy that they've got. Yeah. And it feels like, just based on what I've heard, we were talking to John Strickland about this the other day, they've got a bunch of instinctual guys at the running back position. So you mentioned
You walk back some. Sorry, I said average at best. I don't want anybody to think I meant Mario was average at best. He was better. He was pretty good. I just want to make that point clear.
You weren't being critical. Yeah. No, not at all. All right, so you mentioned the wide receiver room, and I threw this at John the other day, and I'm just trying to think about it from like a mind frame, you know, a mentality, being in a locker room, how things can be. If you don't have a strong locker room, these things can affect it. So we've got Nick Harbor, right, who Hale is pursuing a dream of playing, of participating in the Olympics, wearing USA across his chest. I, for one, am in full support of that. If you get a chance to represent your country in anything, you should do it. And you should do it proudly, and everything else should play second fiddle. He clearly is on scholarship to play football at South Carolina, of course, but he is participating 100% with track in the spring. Hats off to him. And that was the deal coming in, no doubt. But then, Hale, you start to add different layers to this roster, right? Because it's ever-changing. And so when Nick came to campus last spring, now he's got a whole other group of guys who've come to campus this spring, specifically those who play his position, like Gage Larvidane and Jer Brown and Amari Huggins-Bruce, guys like that at the wide receiver position who are running out there every day and they're practicing hard and they're playing. And then here's Nick Harbor, who shows up for practice sometimes. He stands over there and he watches it, and then he goes back and runs track. I'm not saying there's going to be a problem. That's not what I'm insinuating. I'm not trying to stir up anything. I'm just trying to wrap my brain around that room. Will they embrace that? Like, hey, man, welcome back, Mr. Five-Star. Good to see you're back off the track. Or like, man, I've been working my rear end off for the last 3 months. You just show up here, late summer, early fall, because the Olympics are in the late summer, and you just show up in the fall, and you're just out here just taking reps away from the rest of us. That there's an interesting dynamic to that if you allow that to happen. I think that'll be something to watch. Would you agree or disagree with that?
I mean, I can't really speak for the players, but I do know this is a generalization, but like players know who's going to be a better, bigger, faster, stronger type of guy. Like, and there's not a receiver on this roster right now who's bigger, faster, or I don't know, stronger, but definitely not bigger or faster than Nick Harbor. Mm-hmm. He brings something to that room that nobody's got in there from a skill standpoint, or just raw ability standpoint, I should say, as far as athleticism goes. There might be some better wide receivers, some better pass catchers, some better route runners. But what he brings is a totally different dynamic. And he's going to certainly have to earn his reps and playing time and all that. But I think also there's probably going to be a little bit more in terms of what he's got would have to compete with in the summer. Once August camp rolls around and this team truly is what it is, and we see whoever they get from the portal, like I think we all know that they're probably going to try to get some bigger type of bodies in April, or at least that's the hope. That's the goal. That's what they're trying to do. That's what they're going to try to accomplish. So those are probably going to be the types of guys who are going to be competing with the Nick Harbor for snaps. So I don't know that like Gage Larvadane and Jared Brown and Amari Huggins Bruce and the freshmen and whoever else is coming back on this team. If Nick Harbor steps in and plays over those guys, I would think for the most part, they'll probably, if that's how it happens, they'll probably kind of understand why, because he is what they aren't. And that's big and I mean, these guys, a lot of those guys are fast, but he's big and fast.
Yeah. You play the best players. Have you learned anything about who Lenore Sellers has been developing the best chemistry with out there on the field?
I can't really speak to that. No.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. All right. To the defensive side, how about the safety spot? It's a blue collar group. I think they're a blue collar group. Just remembering the recruitments of all these guys.
Sure. Yeah.
I feel like they're a blue collar group. What have you learned about them early in spring practice?
I don't know that I've necessarily learned anything. For me, it's probably just a matter of seeing what we saw in November for the most part over the course of the season. And I think we heard Torian Gray kind of address that on Thursday when he was talking about wanting the guys to be like flat line, consistent, no peaks and valleys, because there were some valleys last season for sure. And I think they feel pretty good about how things have sort of taken shape with Kilgore being able to play nickel and DQ and Nick at safety. And I think they're pleased with what that looks like right now and are moving forward, really excited about it. And to your point, I agree about the blue collar statement you made there, JB, with Nick being lightly recruited out of Irmo and DQ. He wasn't even really supposed to be on the team in 2021. And until they decided to make him part of the team with the whole gray shirt, blue shirt thing. And then he played second most snaps on defense for a guy who almost played quarterback at Georgia Southern. Then Jalen Kilgore, who was, he had a South Carolina offer before he had a 24/7 profile. That's a blue collar type of unit. And I think the staff likes what they have from those guys, by and large, from off the field stuff. I think they feel really good about what those guys add, as well as the on field talent.
Hale McGranahan with the Big Spur. It's 11/31, April 2nd. Somebody I know's birthday is today. So if you're listening and I know you, happy birthday. I've been thinking about that all morning long. I have no idea who it is, but I can tell somebody I know's birthday is today. All right, the corner position. One seems settled. The other seems like there's three or four competing. I think you kind of tipped on that at the top of our segment here. Have they discussed anything? I'm sure we'll hear more from Shane today. We probably should do this with you on Wednesdays after Shane actually speaks. But obviously that's another battle that is that's got a lot of talent and much more depth. But it seems like, we're good over here, but you four guys over here, y'all have to figure it out. It's an interesting spring situation.
Yeah, so O'Donnell Fortune has entered as the starter. I don't know if enough time has passed for them to determine whether or not he still is a guy. I mean, Beamer talked about it last week. Like, it varies really period to period, practice to practice, who's – with the first 11 and all that, it's pretty fluid. And I was surprised when we kept seeing Judge Carter being that third cornerback off the bench or onto the field last season. Maybe Vicari Swain was a little behind him because Judge was able to go through spring practice and get ahead and not allow anybody else to catch up. And who knows, maybe that'll continue to be the case. I mean, he's a big, tall, long-armed-looking fellow who who's got some skills, and I'm very intrigued about what he's going to look like here in year two, and certainly intrigued about Makari Swain and what he's going to look like as a full-time cornerback for coming up on a year now. And Emory Floyd, now that he's not running track anymore, and Jaluis Solomon showing up here in a couple months. So, there was a point in January when I was wondering what the heck the staff was doing and why they weren't really going after any cornerbacks in the portal. And I think I kind of said it back then. It was like, maybe they feel pretty good about the guys they got. And if they see anything that makes them think otherwise during the spring, they could revisit the whole portal thing in April. So based on the interviews that these coaches have given and some things I've heard behind the scenes, they like the group and are pleased with what they've got so far, competing for that spot, and more is on the way.
We've got Schubert in here looking for the beef up there in Chicago. Yeah, so JC says often about the Rock Hill kids, Manny, you just don't count out kids from Rock Hill, man. And Judge Collier is a Rock Hill kid, of course. Interesting little nugget on him, in case anybody was wondering, and I don't know why you would actually wonder this, but his major is, he's an art studio major. Art studio. For a guy from Rock Hill who will knock you into next week, and he's got a great name, you could kind of feel the face. Another blue-collar guy, Hale, honestly. Kind of fits the mold for that type of dude. OD is an interesting case, too. So we had a chance to spend some time with him last year. Remember, JC, at the NIL events. And do y'all remember when he took the pick 100 yards in the Gator Bowl? And he runs into the end zone, and he just kind of stood there, and somebody tapped him on the helmet, kind of walked over to the sideline, catching his breath, didn't really do much. And you think, man, for a guy that just ran 100 yards, no, well, I get being out of breath, but for a guy that just ran 100 yards, you'd think he'd have a little bit more excitement to him. And then once we got to spend some time with as they call him, OD, last year, I learned quickly that's kind of his personality. You know, he'll jump around a little bit here and there, but he's really kind of a silent assassin. And I remember last year, Coach Beamer mentioning, not in those exact words, but like, we almost need him to understand how good he is and how good he can be. You know what I mean? Like, dude, you're a good player. Go out there and act like a good player. Because it felt like he had a confidence problem at times. But from everything we've all continued to hear, Hale, and of course you hear as much or way more than we all do, the talent, if it can stay at a consistent level for four quarters, they feel like the sky's the limit for this dude.
Yeah, I remember, I think it was around this time last year when Beamer was talking about Fortune and was pleased with where he was from a buying standpoint and doing all the stuff that he needed to do to maximize his ability. And I think he might have even like knocked on wood just because he didn't want to jinx it, because they're finally at that point where it was, all that stuff was happening and it was paying dividends. And you know, he certainly missed some time during the season, this past season. So, it hasn't been, you know, all hunky dory, but from an on-field standpoint, and I don't think, don't get me wrong, I don't think there's any major concerns off the field. He had to miss some time for whatever reason. But I think they're real pleased with where things are at with O'Donnell Fortune, because I mean they're talking like it's his job and he's got it locked up, and I think they feel like it's locked up because he's going to continue to make sure it stays that way.
I think that's a good point. I don't think that Shane Beamer or Torian Gray would go out on the limb like that. And even though he's not going to stand, you know, he's going to continue to give you the coach speak. Well, all positions are open. Everybody can earn a starting spot. Yada, yada, yada. We hear you. But I mean, as you pointed out, they've given a lot of grace to O'Donnell Fortune as a starting corner. And we just turned into April here. And I'm not so sure that they would do that if they had any concerns about his work ethic or his development or things of that nature. Torian Gray wouldn't. He's got a track record of doing the exact opposite, as a matter of fact. All right, good stuff. JC, did you get anything today, or are you talked out from Andy Staples this morning on JC and Morgan?
Oh, Tuesdays are tough when I do JC and Morgan because I do an hour with Gunner too, and it's just like,
yeah.
I was taking
it's about 20 minutes, 40 minutes of commercials and about 20 minutes of talking with
Gunner. Yeah, yeah. You gotta talk fast on that show because you'll all of a sudden start hearing a commercial in your ear. I was taking a leadership rep, like Champions of Life used to say, Butch, and writing down all the defensive backs from Rock Hill since, you know, that I could remember. Rick Sanford, you gotta go with the OG to begin with. Derek Ross, who played at Ohio State, Jeff Burris, who played at Notre Dame, who was a really good player. Tony Watkins, y'all remember him with the Gamecocks.
That was my guy, Simpson, man.
Coach Simpson, Jonathan Joseph, Louisville these days is technically in that area. So you could include Sheldon Brown, Stephon Gilmore, Devontae Holloman. Fentrell Cypress starts for Florida State. He's from Rock Hill. Yeah. And then Darion Kendrick played for both Clemson and Georgia and is in the NFL with the Rams. So I'll take Judge Collier to me. I mean, you know, that's probably just the next guy. He didn't go to one of the public schools up there. He went to one of the charter schools or a charter school. So maybe he's a little under the radar. I know the Gamecocks tested him at camp, and while he didn't have like a 4.440, he jumped crazy numbers and was very athletic. And when he played last year, guys, he was, I don't know that he stood out, but he was solid. I mean, you didn't really notice him, and that's good when you're playing corner. Mm-hmm. So my prediction here is Judge holds on to it. I know the other guys are ranked higher. I know the other guys in a straight line probably run faster, but I think Judge is better and probably will hold on to it. And it'll be interesting to see kind of where things go with Swain and Floyd if they don't overtake him this year. Not that those guys aren't still young and can do some stuff here, because that would be disingenuous to say, but I think that's a very under the radar battle right now at that other corner spot.
How about to kind of piggyback on that too, Hale, going back to the depth conversation we had earlier, and I know you mentioned both lines of scrimmage. Obviously, this is becoming a talking point with this team. Is, man, they've actually got a bunch of defensive ends, and they've got 5 year or a bunch of 5th year tackles, and they got a bunch of players now. What have you learned about the scheme? Because we saw them kind of shift a little bit last year, kind of like a 3-3-5. But we've heard, well, no, that's not going to be our base defense. You know, we're going to do that. What are we learning about what they're going to, like, what is their personality going to be over on that side of the ball? Have you heard anything?
Yeah, they're going to be flexible between the 4-2-5 and 3-3-5. They're going to mix and match, and it's going to be kind of a hybrid. What Clayton White referred to it as a couple weeks ago was a flex nickel type of deal. So they're going to be flexible between the two, four down and three down, and nickel is going to be the base. So I guess you could just say that's the base defense is a nickel defense, and whatever it looks like is probably just going to depend on who they're playing and what they like to do and what the matchups look like and down distance and where they're at in the game. So it's going to be a little bit of both. How much more they do 4 down versus 3 down, I don't know. Maybe I'll spend some time this offseason after spring practice trying to see how much they did with the 3 versus the 4 when they started doing the 3 against A&M, and if there was any trends or any kind of way that it evolved. I'm kind of curious to see what that might turn up. I know the coaching staff certainly has that information, but they're probably not just going to willingly give it to me or put it out there during an interview that's on YouTube. So maybe I'll have to do my job and try to figure that out a little bit. But I think it's because they have, like you said, more defensive ends and another veteran at tackle and a bunch of pretty good linebackers, they can play with that thing a little bit and mix it up.
Yeah. I think it's interesting. Y'all remember the what year was it? Got was it oh when did they bring the rabbit package in? That was Lawing.
The whole Lawing tenure. Yeah, the whole time.
The rabbit was there. Package.
Wasn't it
the
like rabbit. 07 when they started that or 08?
They started it then, but it really came to fame when they had Melvin Ingram and Clowney.
Right.
I think it was 11. And what they do, they'd slide Melvin was 280, so they'd slide him in. And this wasn't every passing down because there were some where Melvin came off the edge and they'd have Clowney actually on the inside, which was pretty genius.
Yeah.
At times. Yeah. Because he got Clowney against the guard, but they'd slide Melvin in. I think Aldrick Fordham would slide into the other DT spot, and then they have Taylor still on the other outside. Yeah. And then Clowney would come off the other edge. And so, you know, could you do that with this group? Yeah, but these days,
I wasn't insinuating that, by the way.
They have some bigger DN types. I mean, you can slide Elijah Davis in on passing downs. I think you could probably slide JT Gear inside on passing downs. I don't know that would be ideal because right now the most proven pass rushers on the team are interior guys and linebackers. These guys, Clayton White and these guys, when they're kind of doing something special for pressure, when they have three linebackers on the field, they love to bring the third one, Bam Martin Scott, if you remember that. When he got on the field, he and Jerron Willis last year in the three-man front, they would blitz a lot. And he and Clayton likes to blitz his linebackers, period. he lets them loose. Turn them loose. And they turn them loose. All right. So that's going to be interesting, especially with more speed at that position and the emergence of Bam Martin Scott. How much do they blitz the linebackers? Do you have the athleticism now to drop ends into coverage at a higher clip and a better rate on the inside? You know, obviously, I think Tonka and TJ and Boogie, to a certain extent, have proven they can get after the passer from the interior. Mm-hmm. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. But this defense has a lot of different – he has a lot of different tools in the toolbox this year. Whereas in past years, you looked, and I don't think it was ever this – there was ever this much flexibility at each position. Clint even brought up somebody I forgot when I stood on the table and projected Judge Collier to hold on to the job. I'll add a caveat: if David Spaulding's healthy, David Spaulding may win that job. David Spaulding, every time he's been on the field at Carolina, he's made what does he do? What does he do, guys? He makes plays.
Well. He's been here for 6 years, it feels like. He's played about six games.
He played three games last year and had an interception. I mean, the guy just has a knack for making plays. I remember at Kentucky last year, the guy was a big time. He's just right place, right time. And, you know, if he has the hips to play corner, that would be my question about him. I'm not saying he doesn't. Then that could be a guy. I mean, that's kind of what they were talking about him as. And then he ended up being the starting nickel. Now, I think with all the issues you had at nickel last year, where some guys just aren't nickels, which is surprising to me, but I guess some guys aren't. I think they found the right mix. And what, who is it? Kilgore that's playing there now. Hale, yeah. Kilgore ended up at nickel.
Yeah,
leave him at nickel. I mean, just don't. Let's not tinker with that. That was costly last season. And let Smith and Emenore be back there, and then you know. Get Keenan Nelson Jr. up to where he can maybe be the backup nickel, and then let Spaulding play that corner. And this is unless there's injuries. But I talking to somebody inside the program the other day, they're very high on the secondary. They think there's not another school in the country that can really have that really has three guys like Emenore and Smith and Kilgore. I think they're all future NFL guys. And frankly. There you go, Hale. You'd have to go back to 2010, another blue collar secondary, in my opinion, where you had Culliver, Swearinger, Holloman, Gilmore, and then another corner that ended up in the NFL as well. I don't remember who
they all played in the NFL.
They all played in the NFL. All five starters in the 2010 secondary played in the NFL. And you know what? Everybody griped that year about Gilmore. because there were some plays where they got crossed up. El Antonio Allen was on that team too. I forgot.
No,
there were some plays the safeties got crossed up, and Gilmore would be chasing the guy, and they think he got beat, and he didn't. So that was an interesting narrative that year. So, oh, this secondary is terrible.
Yeah.
Five NFL guys on the field.
Well, Hale, speaking of columns, you've got a big column to write here on the name gang, the linebackers. You've got a guy named Bang, Bengali Kamara, the transfer from Pitt. You got Bang, you've got Bam, you've got Meat, and you've got Debo. So post spring, you've got to put something out on that nickname.
I mean, they were pretty good last year that way too, with Stone and if you want to call Pup. Pup's pretty good, right? That was a good little name.
Well, then the freshmen sound like partners at a Manhattan law firm. Wendell and JR. Wendell and JR. I am Wendell and JR. This is Pup, Meat, Poot, whatever.
Right.
I'm Wendell and JR. I love that. That's delicious.
Oh man. All right. Hale, we'll get you out of here on this. Anything on the recruiting front that you'd like to pass along?
Yeah, they got Jalen McGill in for a visit today, the 2026 running back from Broome High School in Spartanburg.
Ooh.
He's on campus right now as we speak, watching practice. He's phenomenal. People are gonna go crazy about him once they start paying more attention to that 2026 class. I really like him. He's an awful good player. JC feels the same way, I know. And yeah, he's visiting today.
Broome has one of the best mascots, South Carolina High School football.
They're Centurions.
The Broome Centurions.
Jalen McGill.
Jalen McGill. Yep.
And boy, they never win at much of anything. They have good football every now and then. Broome. I think Broome's maybe a baseball school. It's district, so it's east of Spartanburg, between Spartanburg and Gaffney. So not necessarily the growth side of town, like those of us who were privileged enough to go to Burns on the west side of town. Anyway, I had some friends that went to Broome. It's in Cowpens, basically. I heard of the Battle of Cowpens.
Oh, yeah. Broome High School. One of my college coaches is from Cowpens. It's Cowpens, not Cowpens. Cowpens.
You got the dual metropolises of Cowpens and Paclet.
Don't tell a Spartanburg County native how to pronounce Spartanburg County towns, JB. Let's keep your low country opinions
down. No. I'm saying that's what I was told by Bubba, who's from Cowpens.
Okay. I don't know, man. My aunts or grandma, they grew up on the east side of Spartanburg. They called it Cowpens.
Cowpens. Yeah, it was two things. It might as well have a hyphen in it.
Honey, how did you pack your lunch today? Honey, we're taking a field trip to the Cowpens battlefield. Y'all ever did that field trip? Cowpens battlefield. That accent's peak Spartanburg middle-aged woman. Hey, honey, how are you doing? We're going to the Battle of Cowpens. We're going to learn about history today.
History.
I was in church the other day, and my God, look at that bonnet she had on. Just bless her heart.
Hale, we'll let you get in a sandwich and a quick drive over to the, I don't know, where are you going to the facility? That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
yep.
Have fun, Hale.
We'll look forward to the reports today following Shane Beamer's press conference. Always glad to have you, my man. Hey, somebody in here, by the way, gave you a...
the Will Muschamp comment?
Yeah.
What do you think about that? I've heard that a lot, surprisingly. Okay. It's come up before. I don't see it.
Yeah. I don't maybe either. Maybe the hair a little bit. I don't know.
That I mean, I heard it going back to when he was still here, and I mentioned it to him one time, and he's like, "Oh, well, that's good for you." I was like, "Well, what does that say about you?" I said, "What does that say about you?" And he's like, "I guess that's not so good for me." So that was.
Maybe it's a, I don't know. Maybe it's the polo and the hair. I'm not sure. But you've been getting the first question lately in the other press conference I listened to the other day. It seemed like you ask every single question.
Oh.
Why? Well, I mean, so are you favored payoff status now?
Did you pay off DC? What's going on there?
Yeah.
I mean, he's been covering women's basketball,
which
I do not cover basketball really like Tony. So I wasn't at the press conference last Tuesday, but I've been at every other one this spring, and There's been times when it's me and one other person asking questions. So
that's what only, I think I call it.
Because there's only two other people in the room. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, we appreciate you, you know, asking those questions. And when David gets back, don't let him, you know, you don't just get to come back in and sit in the front row again and get the first question, dude. Like, that's not how this works. You got to put in your time around here. So put him in his place.
I, you know, I honestly don't care.
It's really not that big of a deal, man. It's all good. You know, first, fifth, whatever works.
Yeah.
Hey, man, I really appreciate it. Have a wonderful week, Hale. And we'll talk to you next week.
All right. See you guys.
All right. Man, thanks, man. Too. There you go. Hale McGranahan with the bigspur.com. It's 11:53 here on this Tuesday. Looks like it's the last warm, real warm day for a little while. We've got the cool, brisk air coming in. It's going to be a rainy start to your Wednesday tomorrow. That will not affect tomorrow night's baseball game. They will play, but then it will be a chilly. However, it will be a sunny weekend for the third-ranked Texas A&M Aggies to walk into Founders Park. The last time number three came to town, it didn't end so well, so Gamecocks hoping to double up on that. We're going to talk to Grayson Greiner in the 1 o'clock hour about that series and also about his new avenue in his professional life, being up there in the booth. Some, I don't know if he'll be in the booth tomorrow night, but I know he's hoping to call more games on the SEC network. And he certainly did a wonderful job with that last week. Good stuff from Hale, by the way. Good stuff, Hale. Great stuff. Great report, Hale. I know you're still watching. He was a big fan of Phil's and his mustache.
Mad Dog PI.
My God. My mother loved Magnum PI. Wow. That was her. Tom Selleck was kind of her crush back in the day.
Man, that Tom Selleck is just a gorgeous man.
Hey,
he has that effect on
him. I like Tom Selleck.
I always got him and Burt Reynolds confused a little bit when I was a kid because they both had mustaches.
Better actor, Burt Reynolds or Tom Selleck?
Oh, that's close to me.
Ooh, that's tough too.
They both were good.
Oh, you know what? I'm gonna give the edge to Bert.
Yeah, me too.
I'm gonna go with Bert too, simply because
why
the Turd Ferguson?
The Saturday Night Live.
I got a T-shirt that says Turd Ferguson on it. It's pretty awesome. Yeah, Turd Ferguson. That sounds like a good name.
I'm gonna go with his Cannonball Run. That's what really gets me.
Yeah, Smokey and the Bandit. Yeah, he was
Smokey and the Bandit.
I was about to say, Smokey and the Bandit, like y'all talk about Fivers and Dimers. Smokey and the Bandit 1, all-time dimer. Every time it's on, I watch it. Always will.
One and three are in heavy rotation here at this house, but 2 essentially is non-existent. We don't watch the elephant one.
Really?
Nope, don't do 2, but definitely like 3. Even though it doesn't have Burt Reynolds in it. But, you know, because
I was about to say,
Snowman, he gets to be the Bandit. Snowman.
Like, if they ever try to remake Smokey and the Bandit, you don't do it. You know,
it's coming.
Or do it after I'm dead. Like, I don't want to have to see somebody.
It'll have Adam Driver in it.
I mean, who's really going to be Sally Fields was a fox in Smokey and the Bandit. You know, who's going to be Sally Fields? You can't be Sally Fields now.
Jennifer Lawrence.
All right, Jennifer go ahead and Lawrence. Remake it then. Go ahead and Driver. Remake it with Jennifer Lawrence. Never mind, I'm in.
I'm in with Jennifer. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, that's
a game changer.
Let's do it. All right, it's time for a timeout. We're powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston. Man, I just mentioned the weather. You want to be out.
And everybody that could have played the sheriff is dead. Philip Seymour Hoffman could have played that role.
Nah.
Chris Farley could have played that role. In a high comedy type of way. John Candy could have played that role. He would have been too old by now. Who else? I guess John Goodman's too skinny to play that role. He's lost too much. Well, I don't know. John Goodman could still be Buford T. Justice.
Yeah,
he could pull that off.
John Goodman. Okay, we're still good.
All right, we've got half the cast, Sydney Sweeney and John Goodman. We'll figure out the rest of it after the commercial break. Hang tight, ITG will be right back.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
the screen, and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Brewer. His second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer. Turns the corner. Touchdown, number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer. Ryan Brewer Fence, the website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina, and we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man. The building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
I said, oh Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barndo Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company, Gamecock, owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in, because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let a Big Ten stop, and originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Yeah, myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers.
because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring. And they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
National anthem on Inside the Gamecocks, the show proudly presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. Billy G's Carolina Barbecue.com, where you can order your catering for whatever it is. It's March or April. March was last month. It's April this month. May is next month. That's when graduations begin. So if you need catering, anybody out there? I know that they've been taking catering orders left and right. They're also the official barbecue of Gamecock Baseball. You can find them behind home plate under the press box and pretty much under Coach Tanner's suite almost. And you can find them high, deep, and far down the right field line. It's really not that far. When you walk in the center field fence, go to the left and down the right field line, there they are, Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. And there's the menu for 2024. The Big Tex, the Big Porker. I wouldn't be able to decide, Phil. So I'll be up there in a couple of weeks for the spring game. And then for the Arkansas game on that Sunday, and then our golf tournament, or the Big Spur golf tournament Monday. So I kind of figure that Sunday I'll just order the Big Tex, the Big Porker, and the Mac Attack, all of them, and just see how far I get. How about that?
Yeah, and that's the thing, is like you just go for a weekend series and then, you know, try each one, each game.
Yeah, I'm just going to mosey through all of them, and I know how they all taste, so, and they're all excellent, so that's why I couldn't choose. CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com to have Carolina Gold, the Sweet Heat, and the Secret Spice Rub sent to your doorstep. And then coming this July, I think it's July, pretty sure it's July, I don't want to, let's just say coming in the middle of the summer to a food line near you, Billy G's Carolina Barbecue's products. You'll be able to go in there and sauce it up yourselves at a food line near your home. JC, Phil, and myself, JB, here until 2. Grayson Greiner coming up in the 1 o'clock hour, thanks to Hale McGranahan. So how about the women's games last night? The first half, the LSU-Iowa game, it was a great game, and it worked out like I kind of hoped it would. With Iowa winning. But the first half itself, until Iowa kind of took control there in the third quarter, that was probably the best half of women's basketball that I've seen. I don't know how long, maybe ever. I don't know. I mean, it was something. They were knocking them down, and Iowa escaped.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was Caitlin Clark lived up to the hype. I mean, if you've never seen her before and you waited this long, you can kind of see what she's all about. Yeah, right. That's true. Yeah, you kind of see what she's all about there. Yeah. I'm hoping that the women on Friday for K Carolina will get through the Wolfpack ladies and face off against. Well, you know, it's interesting. Okay, so South Carolina has played UConn, yes, but has not played UConn with a full power Paige Beckers. And I think that would be an interesting matchup. Either way, I think the fighting Caitlin Clark's there will also be, you know, a fairly decent game either way you slice it, but you're going to have incredible storylines either way. Cause you got, you know, Gino and Dawn on one side of the thing, and then you'd have Caitlin Clark on the other, against, you know, this upstart, fresh, undefeated new five starter team that Dawn Staley has put together. And I mean, talk about the quintessential reload. That's exactly what happened down there this year.
I wouldn't be surprised to see UConn beat Iowa pretty soundly.
Yeah.
Soundly.
Well, I think everybody's, you know, sports. Sometimes we sort of learn over time not to poke the bear, so to speak. Those folks in stores have been really, really good for a long, long time. And old poor Gino, you know, he's whining all year. And oh, we're just not as good. And they're getting beat by this team and that team. And Carolina handled them pretty good. And lo and behold, here they are.
Oh, yeah.
Juju Watkins, mm-hmm. No problem. You know, we got – and they're healthy. And, you know, they're not the deepest team out there. So I think their matching up against Carolina is going to be difficult. But can they beat?
Well, matching up against Iowa is going to be difficult. I mean, running up and down the floor, their five starters average over 30 minutes a game. I mean, they're going to have to be
in good shape. But.
Yeah, like, I mean, now they're used to it. They're used to it. Like, they're conditioned for this.
I think just don't count them out. That's all I'm saying. Don't.
Oh, no.
I wouldn't count them out.
That's a rule
in college sports. Don't count.
I do think it's good that they're in it. I think it's better that they're in the Final Four. No disrespect, and I know Juju Watkins is a big name and the whole nine yards. But Southern Cal is not a big name in women's basketball. UConn is, and I think it's better for the Final Four that they beat them last night. That's going to. Did you see the over unders for these games on Friday? Have y'all seen that yet? Mm-mm. Deal with two games, man. UConn, Iowa, run up down the floor, knock them down. Over under at 162.5. And Iowa is a 2.5-point favorite. So essentially saying 82-80 would be the final score in that. And the Gamecocks and the Wolfpack, the total is 139.5.
So
70-69 kind of. But Carolina's an 11.5-point favorite.
Well, the Gamecocks are the best defensive team in the country. I mean, I think I don't know what the stats say, but I think they're really good. NC State, that's a team that's given Carolina trouble the last couple times they played. State came to Columbia and won, I think it's pandemic year. I think the year after that, it was a fourth quarter game in Raleigh, and Carolina pulled away to win it. NC State's kind of the epicenter of college basketball. Well, actually, it's crazy because you have two schools that have men and women in. NC State's probably the most unlikely. You know, they're the Cinderella, but it's you know, that's not going to be an easy matchup. But you know, it's kind of a familiar type opponent. I mean, everybody at Carolina is familiar with who NC State is, and vice versa. They've played in sports through the years a lot. I mean, South Carolina's athletic director, where'd he go to school?
Yeah,
NC State. North Carolina State University.
So let's bring this conversation back now that we know that the Final Four is set. Then, who is the villain of the women's Final Four?
NC State.
The villain?
Because of Dave Dorn.
No, JC, come on. Be serious. Who is the villain of the women's Final Four?
It's Gino. If it's not Gino, if everybody's soft on Gino now because, oh, well, he was the poor old guy and had a hard time. And the old lead, you know, same reason everybody pulled for Brett Favre with the Vikings and Michael Jordan with the Wizards. If you think Gino's that far gone, I don't. if it's not Geno, it has to be South Carolina, doesn't it? Because Clark, yeah, well, Caitlin Clark. Yeah. I know ESPN is going to think of South Carolina because those girls in that studio and everybody that runs the women's basketball apparatus in Connecticut up there in Bristol, they're like sitting there almost about to chew their fingernails off because, oh my God, it's their darling player, Caitlin Clark, who deserves it. You know, the girl they've been hyping all year and their Michael Jordan and all that against their favorite team in the world, the Connecticut Huskies.
It's going to be interesting listening to some of them dance.
How are they going to get through this? Oh my gosh. I mean, that's got to be a butt clenching type of experience for the studio crew there. You know, whereas if it was if NC State and Carolina were on opposite, easy, that's easy for them. You know, it's all about Connecticut and Iowa. But, you know, guys, I read today where resale tickets for the Final Four, for women's Final Fours, are out astronomical. Like, oh, ridiculous.
Bet. Yeah.
Like, because of all this. And I did some distance calculations from each city to Cleveland. It's all about 8 or 9 hours. Iowa City, Columbia, Raleigh, Storrs, all the same distance. So,
no.
Miss Clark is really.
You've got.
I mean, drawn a lot of interest to the game, to answer your question, I think it's probably going to end up being Dawn because I think the narrative is going to be pushed by the four letters that old Geno, Grandpa Geno, you know, benevolent old Geno, he's
kindly
he's,
old soft spoken,
somehow put it all together this year against the odds. He's all, you know. Kind of like when people used to pull for Steve Spurrier when he got to South Carolina because, oh, he's doing so good. And he still wanted to beat you by 40. And he's still the same old Steve, but he's much more likable. But I think they're going to play that card. I don't agree with it. I think Geno R.E.M. is still the same entitled, chip on his shoulder, I run the sport type of person that he's always been.
I like Geno, by the way.
I'm not a Geno or – I wasn't a Pat Summit fan either. Maybe I just don't like it.
I'm a fan in today's world of saying what you think. You know what? I don't care that he gets banged up for it. Good for him. He's earned
it. I get it. I don't mind that part of it. I mind the fact that while they were on top, you know, he kind of rubbed it in and stuff. But, I mean, look, he's an underdog guy his whole life. You read his life story. I read a big article. No, it was actually a video about the Geno and Pat rivalry. And what was the funniest part of it, if you guys have ever heard of Philly cheesesteaks, and we all have, in Philadelphia, the two famous cheesesteak places across the street from each other are Geno's and Pat's. Hmm. And Geno, yeah. Ariema, like, said something at a press conference, like, you go to Pat's and it's, you get your cheesesteak and it's old and shriveled up and nasty.
Oh.
And he's like, but you go to Geno's, this is bright lights and delicious food. And I mean, I think that's what that was the final nail with him and Pat Summit's relationship. But a great analogy, because I never really thought about the fact that two iconic women's basketball coaches, that's what the cheesesteaks are also the same names as the famous cheesesteak places in Philly. So, but it's interesting. So I don't know. I still don't like him. I respect him for what he does, but he's still going to get that school's still going to get preferential treatment in this sport, and it always will, as long as the studio is 30 minutes from campus up there, and it is. So that's how they're going to spin it. So I think all said and done, they're going to find a way to make South Carolina the villain. Now, had this been last year's South Carolina team that was a knock you in the face, physical, grind you down, post-oriented basketball team, you know, that's why everybody didn't like Carolina last year, because they were so physical and big. And this year's team wins a little different with pow-pow, full volley in the outside game, three-point shooting, that kind of thing. So it's harder to, like, paint them as, you know, people playing rugby out there, which is what happened unfairly last year. So I think it's harder to make them the villain, but they'll find a way to do it, in my opinion, because or they'll downplay everything they've done. You know, oh, they don't have a star. Yeah, that's the biggest criticism I've heard. South Carolina doesn't have a star like everybody else.
Yeah. Well,
maybe they do. Maybe they have four.
They have 10 stars, actually. Right. They're McDonald's All-Americans. I think I think it changes depending on result. I think going into Friday, everybody, okay, no, that's a blanket statement. Not everybody. I think a large portion of fans who will be tuned in 7 o'clock, 9 o'clock, which, by the way, if you haven't figured it out by now, is like 7:20 and 9:20 on Friday night, will be polling for the darling, NC State. People will have South Carolina fatigue. And then in the late night game, Caitlin Clark has literally broken every scoring record ever. And I think that there's going to be a large portion of, very large portion of fans, Mad Dog, who want to see Caitlin Clark take a ring home as well. I think that's going to be a thing. Now, if Iowa and South Carolina win and compete for the national championship, South Carolina will be the favorite to win the game. They'll be the underdog nationally. If NC State gets to the national championship, they will be the one that everybody wants to win as an underdog if they're playing UConn. But if Iowa and NC State are there, NC State turns into a cute story, but let's see Caitlin Clark get her ring, right? If you know, UConn is there versus NC State, like I said, NC State would get the nod. I'm not so sure if Carolina and UConn are in it. It's probably split 50-50, like JC said. I'm sure there's a bunch of people out there like, man, Geno's getting close to retirement. Let's see him get one more ring before he heads off into the sunset, you know? And then and then the rest of everybody else is like, yeah, we're tired of sitting here listening to ESPN tell us how great UConn's been for 30, 40 years. I hate seeing South Carolina win it again, but like it'd be 50-50. Everybody would have their own narrative, if that makes sense.
UConn, South Carolina would turn into, you know, could you imagine? What's the over-under on the number of times you're going to hear the word dynasty if that's the final, right? I mean, the old dynasty, the new one, the new dynasty rises, the old one. I like it either way for South Carolina because you get through North Carolina State and then you get to play either one of these teams. One, you owe. And the other one, I just really like to see you kind of stick it to one time on the national stage, right? Yeah, it's like, you know, you didn't get your shot when you won the championship to go through UConn because they had already been taken care of in the Final Four ahead of your national championship matchup and spoiled that. And then last year, of course, the Freshies' final run gets spoiled by Iowa heading into the championship, you know, in the Final Four. Right. So either way, I like the story. But yeah, you're right though. The narrative will not be determined for this championship until after both games have been played on Friday. And then it's, you know, it'll either be dynasty, you know, upstart potential, you know, could you imagine having the same two schools win national championships in men's and women's basketball at the same time? I mean, I don't know if that's ever happened in the modern era, but
done it, it'd probably be UConn, right? I guess.
I mean, yeah, you would think UConn would be the one.
I think they did it 1 year.
Didn't they do that? Yeah, I think they did.
Was it? Right? Yeah, I think they have two now that I'm starting to think about it, but yeah, I'm not.
But to your point, I think we're aligning here. If you had, let's say, the Gamecocks got upset by Oregon State, right, and UConn was defeated by Southern Cal, and then NC State made it. Going into this thing, the heavy favorite from the general population would be Iowa.
That'd be
the storyline. Like, let's see Iowa win this thing. It's a classy group of women. Caitlin Clark is, you know, give her the whole story, right? Let's close the book with winning a championship. You know what I mean? Like, but you don't have that now. That's why I asked the villain question. Like, what a lot of people are missing here. Like, we're in South Carolina. Like, I'm talking about the entire country. Like, you got to think about how everybody else is thinking. Think about how we think with football. With 14 playoff, and every year it's Georgia and it's Alabama and it's Ohio State, every year. Do y'all really want to see the same three teams every single year? Like, no, we're all tired of that. So you have to think about how is somebody thinking in the Pacific Northwest or the Midwest or the Southwest or wherever else outside of this little bubble. South Carolina has been the story in college basketball since really like 2017. We're what, 7-8 years into this, the real story, since they started winning championships.
And they haven't won enough, though. I mean, they've only won two.
Well, yeah, I know, but this is their fourth straight Final Four, though. I mean, like,
yeah, they've
been, if Ohio State goes to the college football playoff every year, people are tired of seeing them in the college football playoff. So
that's you don't want to become. You don't want to become Oklahoma or Ohio State, the BCS, Oklahoma, the BCS, where they're the runner-up
every year, not winning it.
Yeah. And everybody's like, not again.
Right, but that's a different conversation. I'm talking about, like, who is pulling for who. And right now, to like Phil just said it, basically what I was saying, you don't have like a general feel for this thing from a villain standpoint or a national support standpoint until you get to the championship, see who's in it. If it's UConn and South Carolina, they're both villains. Half the country, I'm tired of seeing South Carolina here. The other half of the country, I've hated UConn since 2010. I don't want to see them win another championship. You know what I mean? But if you get South Carolina and Iowa, 80-20 outside of this state, pulling for Iowa. Guarantee you. If not more than that. Oh,
God. Everybody at the bar is pulling for Iowa.
Yeah.
And half of them hate Iowa because they're Illinois and Wisconsin. They're at Caitlin Clark. She's going to play some ball. And it used to be like against the rules to turn on women's basketball there. Now with Caitlin Clark, they're like, yeah, and just turn this Caitlin girl on. She's good. Plays for Iowa. She's pretty good.
Well, I mean,
it is a national phenomenon. We're living, and look, it's good for the sport, man. Wish Caitlin Clark played for South Carolina and was South Carolina's player? Yeah, that's great. But I mean, Iowa has been okay in women's through the years. Vivian Stringer, coach there. I mean, they've done all right, but they've never had nobody's had a player like this. And so
Bruin's right, by the way. Else. I agree with, I think hate is a strong word, Bruin. I don't know that I'd go that far, but I do think that there's a lot of people who don't care very much for Dawn Staley across, I'm talking about fans, just like general fans across the country. They've just seen enough of her. Dawn is a media darling. She's on all the time. I mean, and people get tired of that, just like they got tired of Gino, like you just said, JC. You know, people got tired of Kim Mulkey. I'm not saying Dawn and Kim. I'm saying that's not what I'm getting at. I'm talking about the glances that we get at different faces of different sports and how much we have to digest of them over time. Bruin, you're right. You know, Dawn Staley is front and center all the time, front page ESPN, Sports Center, you name it. She's always out there. Everybody wants to hear her opinion on something. Her opinions don't necessarily agree with other people's opinions often. And that trickles down to her program and people get tired of seeing that. So I'm with you. I think that's spot on.
South Carolina's really never had a coach like her since Frank McGuire. I mean, Steve Spurrier is kind of his own guy as far as being opinionated and stuff, but I don't even know that Frank McGuire commanded the attention in the sport as a whole as Dawn Staley simply because of what she did as a player. I mean, she's one of the few that player, coach, whatever, you know, she's been amazing. I mean, she probably could go run an NBA, franchise right now. Mm-hmm. And as a general manager and win. I mean, you probably, just don't count her out, man. I mean, she's done it and she means a lot to the sport. But that doesn't mean that everybody loves her. I mean, Michael Jordan, when he played for the Bulls, I'm sure Detroit Pistons fans didn't love him. You know, I'm sure the Blazers and Jazz and Lakers and whoever the hell else they beat during those title runs. The Suns didn't love him. I was a Hawks fan, Atlanta. I didn't love Michael Jordan until afterward when you reflect on stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I'm sure Auburn people now have a different opinion of Nick Saban than they did 4 months ago, 5 months ago. So
yeah,
yep. It was, it's just one of those things like in sports, but it's going to be interesting. That villain, the villain thing is, it's an interesting thing. And because I think this sport needs villains. Yeah. I think every sport does. Every sport has them. And I think that, you know, and sometimes the villains win and sometimes they don't. You know, speaking of NBA in the 80s, Detroit Pistons, the Bad Boys. You remember those guys? Mm-hmm. The Los Angeles, the Oakland Raiders back in the day. I mean, you know, it's not Miami Hurricanes in college football. I mean, the villains sometimes win. But the villains, let's make no mistake about it. The major villains are out. They got beat by Iowa.
Yeah,
that was the team everybody hated. I mean, you know, for Mulkey and Herdeal to, and you know, and there were, you know, no matter kind of what side of the aisle or your worldview is, LSU had somebody for everybody to not like. You know, I mean, it was there's everybody could point to them, and all that, and then that, you know, so but they're out. So you know, you got to find a new one while you're painting this narrative. And I think it is probably going to be the Gamecocks. And, yeah, you know, like I said, sometimes the villains win.
Well, it means you're good. You know, generally that means you're good. Nobody cares if you lose. If you lose, you're not here.
Nobody's paying attention. Hey, Miami's football players act just like they did in the 80s.
That's a good point. Nobody cares. They don't win.
You know, it's like, I don't give a crap, you know.
Exactly. Yeah, and we got to hit a timeout here. But you take that narrative and then you flip it over to the men like we had this conversation yesterday. Totally different story going into the men's tournament with Alabama, NC State being in there, you know, Purdue being in there for the first time since 1980. Yeah, got a lot of stuff. You got the defending champs who literally have done nothing to make you not like them other than be winners.
They play great team basketball.
A lot of fun to watch, aren't they?
I think Zach Edey's trying to become the villain. I think he's trying really hard. I'm trying real hard to be the shepherd. You know, he's trying real hard to be the shepherd here.
Yeah, but,
I just don't. I, you know, he's a kid that ran his mouth after a game. He's not a. I mean, you've heard anything but good things about Zach Edey the whole year. You know, it was almost uncomfortable. But yeah, Clint, he gets on my nerves too. But
But you overstep. Like Matt Painter is one of the greatest. I mean, how do you not love Matt Painter?
He's man? Awesome. Like, yeah. I mean, I hate their mascot because he's terrifying.
Yeah,
it gives me bad nightmares. It's like like that writer wrote, it's like the last thing you see before you die.
Yeah.
And you know, Edey kind of got on my nerves, and I didn't like the fact he camped out in the lane like he did and they didn't call it, and that they got two home games. But hell, they've suffered enough. They lost to a 16, they lost to Fairleigh Dickinson last year.
Mm-hmm.
As if it was a
16-1.
So it's kind of like Virginia that year they won it. I could care less about the University of Virginia. And those bunch of snobs and choke artists, but I was kind of happy to see him win it because I was like, man, for those fans, that you know, you've suffered a lot, so it's good to have some redemption. So I don't know the men, and I think that's what people talk about too when they talk about the men's game not having a star. The men's game just doesn't have the drama the women's game does. Mm-hmm. The men's game's the fun bunch. You got guys like DJ Burns. Woohoo! Fun bunch, dude.
I mean, right.
Yeah. There's no bad boys. There's not even a fab, you know.
Yeah.
There you go. Sorry, I finished my thought there.
No, but yeah. And I do remember that, you know, UConn did beat South Carolina beat UConn in the championship. But like I said, full power Paige Beckers. Because remember, Beckers broke her knee or leg that year and did not play full minutes in that, because I distinctly remember throughout the entire broadcast how our friends at the Four Letter Network were reminding us that this was not a full power Paige Beckers, and that might be contributing to the reason that South Carolina could be winning this game, blah blah blah.
By like 30,
20 earlier this year. That is the one thing that I will say, there is a gigantic media bias when it comes to UConn women's basketball. I 100% agree with that. Yeah. I don't harp on it like some folks do all the time, but if you ever wanted to see where one exists, it's there.
Let's step aside. It's 12:32, late for a break, but we've got one still ahead. It is Grayson Greiner, also South Carolina's must-win game this year on the 24 college football schedule. What is the must-win game for the Gamecocks? Hang tight. Inside the Gamecocks, the show built by the Barndo Co. We'll be right back.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to Signarama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
Cool Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasporch.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpeper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, three great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com. A tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me. I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you
I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm a lover wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
And
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. Nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
It's 12:40 here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Mad Dog Schubert and JB, Grayson Greiner, coming up in the 1 o'clock hour. Are you looking on the back porch, or have you looked on the back porch and thought to yourself,
we're on the back porch.
You know, I need to make this thing a little bit more enjoyable, maybe a little bit more comfortable, maybe zazz it up a little bit now that the pollen is beginning to dissipate. And if you live in my neck of the woods, as it gets warmer, it'll kill off the no-see-ums. Thank the good Lord, those things serve zero purpose, but they're here. If you are, you need to go to Palm Casual because they've got four locations: Somerville, Mount Pleasant, Myrtle Beach, Bluffton. They are Gamecock owned and operated. They've been in business since 1979. They are the factory. They have the best products. Matter of fact, Aaron, who owns all of them, gave me the stuff that we have put on the outdoors. You haven't, I don't think you've been here since then, JC. And guess what? I'll put a cover over it. Doesn't get ruined, which is fantastic. Because the last stuff we had out there from another store that claims to be something more than they are, it definitely withered away with the sun. So we don't have to worry about that because we went to Aaron and the guys at Palm Casual and they took care of us. Even better than that, you get 30 days with it. As they told me, you can have 29 straight parties. And on the 30th day, if you don't like it, bring it back. We'll give you a check right there. Check. Hand it to you. Here's a check. Here's what you paid. Get your money back. Go on about your business. Palm Casual has been doing this since they opened in 1979. They have always been Gamecock owned and operated. They've got stores all across Florida. They've got a couple in the Atlanta area and then the four here in South Carolina. And I would highly suggest to all of you, if you've got a pool or a back porch or a back deck or a front porch, anywhere in the outdoors, and you want to make it look better, you want to make it the way you want it, like Friday night, Gamecock women's basketball, South Carolina baseball. You're going to have two TVs, and you're sitting in some old torn-up wicker. Maybe head to Palm Casual and have them pull out exactly what you're looking for. PalmCasual.com, partly presenting our program here on ITG. All right. So what is it, guys? Have you even thought about it? It's April. Who's the must-win game for South Carolina football when they kick off in the fall?
At Alabama.
Old Dominion, because you want to win that first one or you're going to lose everybody. Alabama, I like that answer, though.
It goes without saying.
I think people are a little bit like, I don't know. I think people need to really start kind of looking at these teams on the schedule instead of the name on the front of the jersey to a certain extent. I understand anytime you have a bunch of good offensive players coming back, you're going to be ranked higher. Missouri's defense was really good last year. Really good. Go check out what they lost, including their coordinator. And they come to Williams-Brice later in the year. I'm not chalking that one up to a six straight loss to Missouri just yet. Ole Miss is still Ole Miss, guys. South Carolina's beaten them frequently through the years. Now, they haven't beaten Lane Kiffin in two times, but it's at home, too. Here's the one that may shock you, LSU. LSU, like, everybody's like, on that list, Garrett Nussmeier threw for 391 yards in the bowl game. Therefore, you know, he's 31 for 45. My God, let's anoint him. And LSU will mop the floor with Carolina's butt at Williams-Brice, maybe a night game week three. Okay, well, they haven't been to Williams-Brice in how many years? 2008. Malik Nabers is going to the NFL last time I checked. So is Brian Thomas. And they were bad on defense last year. Now they did get Missouri's coordinator. I expect him to be better. So you're telling me they're definitely coming on the road in that type of environment, and not like they're going to Mississippi State where they go every other year. They're coming to a place as a program they have not been in 17 years, and Brian Kelly never has coached. And they're just going to line up and beat the crap out of Carolina because they're LSU. A&M has a new coach, and the reason they're the number two portal ranking in the country, I don't think they got anybody great, to be honest. It's because they lost so many players. And then they got Weigman's a good quarterback. They come to Columbia. Oklahoma, I've talked about them. I don't think they're going to be very good. The game's out there. I would give them the edge out there. But that's not an automatic loss. Kentucky's week two. That's a game everybody wants to win because it's Kentucky, and you got a chance to go Beamer to be 3-1 against those guys and reverse now, that.
Not to be rude and interrupt you here, but are you saying every game is must win? Because you've listed
I'm trying to make a point that the reason you have people saying, like, jumping up and down going, that Kentucky game's a must win in week
two
is because they think they're going to lose all these other ones. And
that's what Brad Crawford stated in his column.
Well, Kentucky Brad's got to write what he's got to write. And it's all based on preseason predictions. But a lot of these teams, guys, could go either way. I mean, we've seen it in the last several years where teams are ranked, predicted. Most people had Missouri sixth in the East last year ahead of Andy. And you saw what happened. And the only people that knew what they had were the Missouri coaching staff. Even their fans didn't. So, I mean, I'm hesitant to sit there and call a game in week two in the conference opener a must win. Now, is it one that I'll be very disappointed if they lose? Yes. And you know why? Because it's time to start beating Kentucky every year again. Okay. They've had their fun. All right. But that's over. All right. That's over. Brock Vandergriff cannot go out and have a big game against Carolina. And that will be very disappointing. And this team under Beamer does need to get off to a better start. This program in general needs better starts. But it's not a must win. I mean, they lose that. They could turn it back. You could come back and beat LSU the next weekend. Nobody's going to give a flip about beating Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's my thing.
What do you have? Kind of in that same vein that you're talking, JC, I think Missouri, if you're going to put Kentucky and Missouri together, Missouri's the more must win. You've got to put a stop to this.
Yeah.
If you're trying to build this program in a now 16 team league and compete for recruits across the entire footprint of the SEC, you need to put an end to this Missouri winning streak. You need to get that back on your side. You know, it's at home. For a trophy. But where it comes in the schedule too is it's at home with two games left to play afterwards. That's going to be pivotal. You know, you drop that game at Missouri for what could be, you know, what people have in their head as a similar situation as last year, where you're at five wins heading into Clemson. You just don't want to create that with Wofford coming in the next week, because then you're not going to have the huge sellout that you're hoping to at home right before you're ending up having to travel away to Clemson 2 weeks later. And you've just got to reverse the course there. Are you a better program top to bottom than Missouri, or are you going to lose to them again when talent wise, I don't really think that there is a huge difference between the two programs right now.
There's not. And you know, program wise, you know, there's team program job. Program wise, you know, they sort of accomplish the same types of things that they go to. But I think Missouri got a leg up on Carolina last year, program wise. I mean, getting to the Cotton Bowl, beating Ohio State, those things matter. Going 11-2, playing Georgia well, like they did on national TV, that matters. And, you know, it's nothing that South Carolina can't leapfrog them at. Job wise, South Carolina's a better job. But program is sort of a long-term measure, and then team is year by year. So, you know, Missouri may have a better team 1 year. Yeah, see, I don't think Kentucky's ever had a better program than South Carolina. I don't think Kentucky's close to being a better job. I think they've had better teams. Mm-hmm. And I think it's been even a lot of years, and the ball's just bounced their way. And you could argue that by South Carolina's way the last 2 years too. But, you know, I agree. I guess if I had to put a gun to my head and one, hey, what's the one you want to win? It's Missouri. And I can tell you this, the coaching staff had two games circled last year. Where they were, Florida and Missouri.
Yeah.
Didn't go their way. You know.
So does anybody know what South Carolina's record under Shane Beamer is in September versus the Power Five?
Power Five?
Ooh.
She doesn't want any.
1-7.
Is there not?
1-7. Yeah, okay. Right. Mississippi State. All right. Ooh. 1-7 in September. I happen to agree with Brad, but for a different reason. I think there's some talent on this football team. I think they need confidence. And they open the year with a chance to begin that confidence building journey at home, as we all well know. Against Old Dominion, the Old Dominion Monarchs. If you can go to Lexington and open the season 2-0 and steal a road win and get off to a 2-0 start and continue that, as you pointed out, JC, and you're right, like they need to continue this. Like, I don't know if we're going to get the 10 in a row again against Kentucky. Those times kind of might be over with how college football has changed and the portal and all those things. But beating those guys, you know, four out of every six is probably a pretty good number. Continuing that streak and giving this football team confidence, knowing that the next week they don't have to go to LSU. They come home and play LSU. And then who do they play after that? They've got Akron. So all of a sudden, and then you got an off week before you have Ole Miss coming to town. So just think about this for a second. Best case scenario. You go to Lexington and you win the game. You don't leave town for over a month, guys. You're not going anywhere until you head to Tuscaloosa Friday, October the 11th, for the game on October the 12th. You are here for three straight home games, and that includes an off week before you host Ole Miss at Williams-Brice Stadium. So I'm thinking about it from a confidence standpoint with the amount of depth that they have. And I do think that they're more talented, but we all agree with that, right? Maybe some positions you'd like. I'm not so sure that we can say right now. We haven't seen it, but I don't think the wide receiver position is more talented than they were last year. They lost two All-Americans. I mean, both those guys are gone. We haven't seen them play. I can't say that the quarterback position is better because we haven't seen them play. I mean, Spencer Rattler is going to be drafted. But this team has more depth than they overall as a group, collectively, 100 players, I think they have more talent. If you can steal it, you steal a road win, and you got three games at home following that, including an off week before Ole Miss, and then you hit the road, you all of a sudden open the doors to not having to deal with anything that you've had to deal with like you did last year where you're 2-6 and all the pressure in the world is on you to just try to keep winning, keep winning, keep winning. I'm not saying there isn't pressure to win games. You get my point, right? Like, you're not up against a brick wall here where if it doesn't get done, the whole season's a failure in October, and everybody is fire everybody, get rid of this guy, the whole nine yards. Like, you don't want to go through that. So if you get off on the right foot and you steal that Kentucky game in Lexington, what follows that, in addition to the fact that your football team has got a lot of confidence going into that home stretch, I think could really, really be beneficial to this program in Coach Beamer's fourth year. Does that make sense?
You beat Kentucky and you get back home against LSU, and you know, I'd have to dig in their personnel and see what.
Can you imagine if they open 2-0 and then LSU's walking in? Y'all know what Williams-Brice Stadium will look like Saturday, September the 14th.
Oh yeah, it'd be the massive light show, and that place would be. I mean, nuts. Think about it for a, you know, think 7 o'clock kickoff, right?
Y'all remember Tennessee from a couple years ago? I mean, just this past year. What we were seeing at the end of the year with Kentucky and then with Clemson, the atmosphere. I think Brad's on to something. I wish he had more time maybe to explain it. I like his pick. I'm just putting my brain behind it.
Yeah, I get you. It's an important game. It's a pivotal game early. I know. I just, you know, when you talk about the whole season, it's a long season, as we know, as we've seen. But like, you know,
let me throw this at you, JC. Let me throw this at you real quick. I get the Missouri thing. Believe me, 100%. Losing to those, I don't think there's a team on the schedule outside of the Tigers that I would hate to see them lose to more than freaking Missouri. It's just it's a sickening feeling, and nobody can ever figure out why everybody loses to them. And it's a sickening feeling. But with that said, what game is that? That's the 10th game of the year, right?
Mm-hmm.
You go into that game at 3-6.
That's what you don't want.
That's my point.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, yeah, you don't want that. Like, I don't think you want, you know.
Like, it would be a must win by the records standpoint, clearly. But, like, to have a successful year, like, I can't pick a game like that. I have to pick an early game that could help set the tone of your season, right, Phil? Does that make sense?
You don't want to be 4-5 heading into that game. I mean, you know, you want to, and I see your point, JB, in that, you know, getting that Kentucky win kind of sets you on a path, right? I mean, you know, to really do it with opportunities coming up at home. You know, it's just, it's going to be interesting, you know, from a talent perspective. I mean, you're not scared of the names. Like, I don't think Ole Miss really frightens you very much, although they've got some returning experience, and the narrative surrounding that game is going to be the Wells defection. You know, LSU, I mean, it's LSU, but, you know, you put a live environment together, being 2-0, having them at home, you got a good chance.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I heard Andy Staples on JCM today say, you know, the rumors of Alabama's demise have been greatly exaggerated with the new Caleb DeVore. But here, let's face it, that's not the same level of talent that Saban has enjoyed year after year. And it's a different coaching staff and a different feel, and you catch them early, you know, even though you're playing them in Tuscaloosa. I'm not saying they're, you know, Carolina's going to go in there and wipe the floor with them, but I think you put a competitive game together that might be four quarters, you know, and you got a shot.
I'll say this about Ole Miss, too. Ole Miss is not going to have a chance to prove they can win on the road until they come to Columbia, because you look at their schedule: Furman, Middle Tennessee State, at Wake Forest, Georgia Southern, and Kentucky. So at Wake is not a road game. All right. No. That is a neutral site game at best. And then Carolina. And they got LSU right on top of that the next weekend. So, which is what that LSU, they want to beat them every year. It's a trap game, kind of, because they got the SEC opener. I think they'll beat Kentucky. Everybody be like, yeah, you know, we're going to go mop the floor of Carolina and then go to Baton Rouge. And they're taking off. We got Oklahoma coming in, and Georgia's down the road coming to Oxford, too. I just don't know, man. I mean, that's programs like Ole Miss that are upstart programs, those are the situations they stub their toe. Like South Carolina, back in the day when Lou Holtz was there and they were trying to emerge, they had no problems getting up for Tennessee and Florida. They didn't always win, but they got up for those games and played relatively well in most of those games. But you send them to Arkansas when they're undefeated and they're going down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's just kind of how it goes. Now, dude, and look, the Juice Wells thing, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't expect, I think I'd be surprised if he played in that game, just to be honest. I just based on some things I've heard. So, and that's as of right now. But you divide Carolina's schedule into quadrants, like or thirds. You know, there's section one, section two, section three. Section one is ridiculous. You know,
hang on to that, because I know where you're going with this. It's the end of the hour. Hang on to that and lead us off with that when we come back. I know exactly where you're going with this, because I was thinking something very similar just a little while ago. Grayson Greiner is still ahead, and we'll get into some Carolina baseball with him right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And chicken cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville, Mount Pleasant, Myrtle Beach, and Bluffton, and online at palmcasual.com for our products and out-of-state locations. Gamecock owned and operated.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barndo Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy installation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned. Gamecock operated.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signarama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks!
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. you can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand. 'Cause I got him for you.
Beautiful state here, don't we?
Oh, yeah. One of the best. If not the best. I don't know. It's getting to the point now where I really would refuse to live anywhere else.
I know.
Really, not interested.
You travel sometimes and you go to, well, JC knows. Yeah, I don't mean, I'm not trying to be disrespectful. I love going and visiting other parts of the country and seeing things, but man, I'm telling you, especially when you drive and you cross that border, it's just something that just makes you feel better when you're back inside of the state of South Carolina. So always holding your hand. We are here on Inside the Gamecocks show. Gamecock traditions will get you dressed and looking good, man. You're probably starting to pack up some of the heavy jackets and stuff like that. Although you'll still need them. Still need some jackets this weekend at Founders Park. Is that high flying, hard hitting offense of Texas A&M comes to town? It's going to be, I mean, when I say like, you talk about perfect weather, 70 degrees and sunny. It ain't any better than that. But when the sun goes down, it still might be a little chilly. But Gamecock Traditions has got all the Carolina baseball stuff. They've got all the Final Four stuff. They've got the new Yeti Gamecock mugs, 20-ounce, 30-ounce. You know, like if you're like me and you like to pour your Dixie vodka and your cranberry juice in the 30-ounce.
That's how I cruise around my neighborhood for Halloween. I'll fill my giant coffee mug up with some chicken cock. That's exactly what happened last year.
I've got
around talking to everybody.
I've got my Letterman's Association Carolina Yeti. People know what goes in that one. I've got this Yeti. People know what goes in that one. So if the golf cart's moving and got the Black Yeti in there, it's probably vodka. If you got the gray one in there, probably bourbon. So anyways, they got all that stuff at, well, not the Letterman Association, but they've got the Gamecock logo Yetis at Gamecock Traditions. You can order online, GamecockTradition.com. There you go, Craig. That's a boat-sized drink. That's right. Yeah, just picture, you know, when I'm on the golf course, I take it on the boat too. We got, you know, take it on the boat. All right, Grayson Greiner coming up. JC, finish what you were saying there. You were talking about some, you know, Chinese elephant in India or something like that who had short ears. You never know. No, finish what you were saying. I hated to interrupt you. We were at the end of the hour there.
Oh no, that's fine. I didn't look at the clock nor hear the music.
I know that. That's what Phil and I are here for.
so you divide it up into thirds. The first third is challenging. You know, kind of like 2022 where you had Arkansas and Georgia. Kind of same concept. You go on the road for a team that's kind of on your level and then come home for one of the traditional titans of the SEC. I don't think LSU next year is going to be nearly as good as Georgia was in 2022, just to be clear. And you got ODU and Akron, so you get a little – and then you get an off day. So you got those four, and then you're off before Ole Miss comes to town. Ole Miss does not have an open date until they come to Columbia. And then it's the sense of humor scheduling where we sat here and said, oh, I bet they give Carolina, Alabama, and Oklahoma back-to-back on the road. And lo and behold, they did. And so it's Alabama, Oklahoma back-to-back. And then you're off again. Texas A&M rounds out this next third. So the second third is a B. The middle of the schedule is a bear. Mm. Ole Miss at home, at Alabama, at Oklahoma, and Texas A&M. This reminds me of a Big 12 or like flashback. Carolina's down the Big 12 because they got to play all these teams. Missouri's coming up. But then if you look at kind of the last third, it kind of is a little bit more like the beginning, although I think people need to watch out for Vanderbilt this year. They got the quarterback from New Mexico State and the OC from New Mexico State. What did New Mexico State do last year? They beat Auburn by 3 touchdowns. What's that offense designed to do? Keep teams with lesser talent in the game? Be careful. I mean, teams got to be careful. I mean, Vandy's not just going to – I mean, that was a good – a shrewd, untalked-about move by Clark Lee, I think.
Okay, let me put you on the spot real quick. Now that you're a Vandy expert, and I get that, but let me put you on the spot with the Commodores. Can they – and by the way, Brad Crawford has their season-defining game against the Gamecocks on November the 9th. Vanderbilt opens – does anybody know who they open with?
Oh, are they?
Who does South Carolina open with in 2025?
Virginia Tech.
They play Virginia Tech.
They've got Virginia Tech in Nashville. How winnable is that game for Vandy?
Not.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's just because the Phil's Hokies, and I call them Phil's Hokies because midseason last year, where I think a lot of us had lost hope for them, Phil starts picking them. Goes on like a heater of 4 straight wins when they finally lost to Louisville and then they won their bowl game. And they're pretty optimistic up there. They got a good quarterback coming back. So I would say Vanderbilt will be an underdog, but let's say Vandy gets better on defense. Clark Lee is a good defensive coach and they run an offense that just kind of like Carolina in basketball this year. They just kind of grind you down. That's what New Mexico State did to a lot of teams. I mean, that could help, but yeah. So after that, who's an Alcorn State?
Yeah. Well, and then they've got the, you know, you mentioned JC Missouri and how they're doing this. They're doing the same thing. They go to Sean Elliott less, but they go to Georgia State.
Yeah. Ole Miss goes to Georgia State in a couple of years too, but
you wonder why are they doing that? Like just to go to Atlanta? Maybe it's a recruiting trip for them at the same time. Go play and go out watch game Friday night.
They scheduled it before Kiffin. Like they scheduled that when Ross Bjork was the AD there. I don't know why. Because like if you look at you look at half the league, the upper half, and they're scheduling like big time across big time teams from other Power Five conferences, home and home. Then Carolina's kind of in the middle. Carolina's scheduling, their ACC teams are playing. And then the Miami series is a nice series. And then they got Virginia Tech way down the road. And they would, before expansion, they probably would have gotten West Virginia. They were working on that. Teams that Carolina's played in the past, that makes sense. But no, that App State game before people start griping about it was scheduled way before Tanner was the AD. And it probably will never be played. But there's no more – so was that East Carolina game they played 2 years ago. There's no more on the road against group of five teams, no more at UCF, no more Navy, nothing like that.
Well, there is one.
But no, but they're going to – they're probably going to – that's a 2034.
Yeah, I predict the same thing. I'm with you. I don't think they'll ever play that game.
And they got a game in Atlanta. So Carolina's kind of right in the middle. Well, then after Carolina, when you get into the Mississippis and Missouris, the two Mississippi schools, Missouri, Vanderbilt, you know, those schools all have scheduled like I think Missouri goes to San Diego State and Northern Illinois in the future. You know, Vanderbilt went to UNLV last year. They're going to Georgia State this year. And then there's Kentucky that's got there. They got their same old deal. You know, Kentucky, Kentucky's got their FCS team. They got two group of fives, two max preferably, and then Louisville, and that's it. So, see, I like Missouri in 2025. They got Kansas at home, and they go at Miami of Ohio the next week, which is weird. You know, I mean, they're going to Oxford, Ohio this year. Missouri in October goes at A&M, at UMass. I think Frank Martin will be out there before the game. Yeah. Auburn at home and then Alabama. So they got at UMass this year, at Miami of Ohio in 2025. And then in 2026, they play Kansas and Illinois, their two rivals, both on the road. So if I were a Missouri fan, you know, everybody talks about ADs all the time. Whatever clown, because your football schedule and the coach has input, but it really rolls through, and he can squash it, but it really rolls through the athletic department in football, right? So whatever clown decided, okay, we're going to go to Miami of Ohio and UMass in back-to-back years, and then we're going to jumble it all up. So in 2026, we have to play at both of our rivals in Lawrence and Champaign when they both rotate back on the schedule.
Yeah.
People think things are incompetent around here. Go look at some other places and other situations. I mean, I'd be pissed if I were a Missouri fan. I'm like, so you're taking a home game away. You're sending me to Amherst, Massachusetts.
Right. Great.
Not even Boston. By the way, they play at, I think they did play at Boston College last year. So I don't know what that deal is. Then Oxford, Ohio, in rural Ohio, ask Derek where that is at some point. And then we got KU and Illinois on the road, but twice on the road, plus the SEC. I mean, come on.
I think too, you mentioned Kentucky. Brad has the season defining game for the Wildcats as Auburn on October the 26th. I would disagree with that. I would put for Kentucky, I would put it down in South Carolina. I mean, the Gamecocks have beaten them the last couple of years. We all know that Kentucky seemingly they had two 10 win seasons, I think, now under Coach Stoops, right? So outside of that, it's one game every year that takes them from 6-7 or 7-8. Every single year, there's one game. And it's generally been two teams, right, guys? Florida and the Gamecocks. Those are kind of the two teams that Kentucky feels like they've caught up with in the East, or maybe even passed. And so, I they go to Florida this year. They host Carol. Interestingly, with how South Carolina's got all the West, Kentucky still has South Carolina, Georgia, Vanderbilt, Florida, and Tennessee. I mean, they play the entire East except for Missouri.
So yeah, they play Texas and Ole Miss from the other.
And they Auburn. Play Texas, yeah, Texas, Ole Miss, Auburn, and. Ole Miss and Auburn. Yeah. And I was going to mention Louisville, but they're not in the SEC. But you've got, so I'm not sure, like when you look at the Wildcats, not that they can't, I mean, you look at all the games that are winnable on their schedule. I mean, I don't know of a game on their schedule that isn't winnable, really. I mean, you could probably circle Texas as the most difficult road trip, I guess. But outside of that, they're probably all winnable. Maybe Tennessee isn't. I don't know. Florida certainly is. They've already proven that. Ole Miss, I don't know. But all those games at home, Louisville, Murray State, Auburn, Vanderbilt, Ohio, Georgia, the game. I don't know if Georgia's a winnable game for them or not. But so why, like if you open the year, if you're Kentucky and you beat Southern Miss, and you get beat by South Carolina at home. Then you get beat by Georgia at home. You're 1-2. You still got road trips to Ole Miss. You got to go to Florida. You got to go to Tennessee. You got to go to Texas. I mean, you start getting back into that old Kentucky, right? Can we count our way to 6 wins? And how do we get to 7? I don't know. I'm confused as to how Kentucky would be. We got to get Brad on. I'll ask him the question. How is Kentucky South Carolina's must-win game, which I agree with, but the Gamecocks isn't Kentucky's that early in the year? With, once again, a flipped-over quarterback room, flipped-over offensive coordinator. I mean, they got all kinds of new stuff going on up there again.
And and Mark Stoops has proven through the years he's going to run what he wants to run on offense. They're not changing. It doesn't matter who the coordinator's been. It's gone from average to bad. They've got another guy that certainly has a lot of talent, but he's a good runner of the football. But it's a new system, new quarterback yet again. They hit the portal hard again. They haven't been the same on defense the last few years. Was kind of shocked with the amount of points they put up against Clemson. I don't know what happened and why that game ended up a freaking shootout, but it did. The flip side of it, they are going to be sky high, jacked out of their minds and ready for that game. You know, you're not going to get a chance for them to get beat up like they do. They're not going to have injuries. They're not going to have the, but maybe it's good. You know, every year Kentucky kind of dominates September, but they always do have that one game against an FCS team or something where they struggle for a while. It's usually game two, too, if they don't have an SEC game. But, you know, game two a couple of years ago, Florida had the greatest one-week hype in the history of college football with Anthony Richardson after they beat Utah. I think game day was there. They went and interviewed Napier and Richardson. They're like, Gators are back, baby. And Florida goes in there. Kentucky goes in there and beats them. And it exposes Richardson for who he is. But, I don't know. Early, you know, they tend to win, but they tend to not have a lot of style points because they kind of feel it out. So I don't really know what to think. South Carolina hasn't been up there or hasn't played them that early, I think, since 15 when they played them in week two in Columbia, I think was that. What did that say? Or week two of Columbia, 17, it was week three. It was the Gamecocks SEC opener. It's kind of weird because last year Carolina played them at the end. Right. Now this year it's the beginning.
It's kind of how it used to be. I like that. I like that. Much like Georgia used to be early as well. It's 1:20. Some quick news, and then Grayson Greiner joining us here in just a couple of minutes. But some quick news out of the SEC. If you happen to watch Jimmy Bell Jr. play this year, you might remember he's 6'10", 280-pound center for the Mississippi State basketball program. He's joined the football team. I have no idea what he is going to do on the football team, but he has joined the football team at 6'10", 280 pounds. Wow. Grayson Greiner up next here on Inside the Gamecocks. The
show. Field goal block team.
There you go. That's the point.
Field goal block team.
There's a new position. Field goal blocker.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpeper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, three great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
The season rolls on at Love Chevy, where the inventory is overflowing and the deals are in full bloom.
Rev up your season with Love's exclusive specials on Suburbans, Tahoes, Silverados, Trailblazers, and the ever-popular Chevy Trax. They're hard to find. At Love Chevy, get behind the wheel and feel the possibilities. New adventures, new destinations, just you and the open road. Act now for Springtacular Savings at Love Chevrolet. The best selection of new Chevys. The lowest price, guaranteed. The other dealers upsell, overcharge, and will say most anything to get the sale. At Love Chevy, satisfied customers say it all. Things like helpful, knowledgeable, honest, and fun. Your trusted hometown Chevy dealer since 1961. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
That's the power of
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock Nation, my name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to McKellarEnterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks.
What's up to the best fans in the country? This is Eli Jones, and you're tuned in to Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Go Cocks.
It's 125. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks. The show coverage of Carolina baseball here on ITG all year long is brought to you by Resto Pros of the Midlands. Jeff Sturgis, the owner, is a great friend, better businessman, great fan as well of South Carolina baseball and South Carolina athletics. Unfortunately, if you have damage from fire or smoke or water or wind or whatever it may be, hail. Yeah, these are the guys who are going to come get it all cleaned up for you, and they'll walk you through the insurance process. Nobody wants to deal with that, but they will help you deal with it, and they're the best at doing that. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Resto Pros of the Midlands presenting our coverage of the Gamecock baseball program. So speaking of covering the Gamecock baseball program, so he played for them, goes to the big leagues, has a fantastic career, cut on the TV. Damn, I think I recognize that voice. That sounds like Grayson Greiner. I'll be damned, that's Grayson Greiner up there in the booth, man. So I texted you last week and I told you you did a good job. I wasn't just saying that to be nice, because
thank you.
There's some people that don't really do a good job, so we don't tell them that. We just don't say anything. You killed it, and my two cents on this is, and you're going to understand it. Catchers make the best coaches. They make the best analysts. You see the game and you feel the game and you hear the game. All those senses so much differently from everybody else on the field. So you're able to process it, from a bird's eye view. And I want to make sure we gave you a public compliment today, because your first time up there was really spectacular. I hope you're proud of yourself, man.
Oh, thank you. It was a lot harder than I thought it would be. I mean, it's like watching the game and commenting on the game is not the hard part. It's, you got a producer in your ear. You got to feel, I hate to say it, I got maybe the worst game possible for my first ever game. It was a 19-14 game with a rain delay. So hopefully they're a little easier going forward, but doing the A&M series this weekend. So I'm excited about that.
And great.
So, and the other thing about the game the other night is there was not that many people there. So it was, you can't really feed off the energy of the crowd. But I'm excited. I was very excited and honored when they called and asked me to fill in for Kip for the Presbyterian game. And I believe we spoke a little bit when I was on before the Clemson series. It's kind of something I always wanted to maybe dip my toe in, see what that side of the game would be like. And I really enjoyed it. I had a blast working with Dave Weinstein of the SEC Network and learned a lot in that first game.
Dave's a great guy, super guy. Obviously, he'll help you along. I think it would be neat too. Like, have you paid attention to some of the broadcasts when Coach Lake and Coach Tanner are up there together in years past? Like last year, I think they did it. Did you ever hear that?
I was still playing.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
So I didn't really get the.
I'm like the rest of us.
We're just really getting
around on a Friday, you know.
Getting the follow-up, yeah.
You were probably in like Chicago or something up there embarrassing JC's White Sox.
They're terrible. My Tiger, it's fun having a team to root for now. Now I can become a Tigers fan full time, and we're 4-0 to start the year. So.
Yeah.
Beat up on JC's White Sox.
Like you, terrible. You spent time in Detroit. Look what's it. Michigan wins the national championship. The Lions get to the NFC title game. Could you imagine if the Tigers won the World Series? The place would fall apart.
No, we Joel Seddon was my college roommate all 3 years, and he's from St. Clair, Michigan, and he's a huge Tigers, Red Wings, Lions, Pistons fan, and Michigan. So when they won the national championship and the Lions were doing their thing, we were just calling it the Winter of Joel because I see him every Wednesday night at our bowling league, and he was rocking his Lions and Tigers. I mean, people in Michigan got it going on right now.
They do, man. It's still cold up there though, but yeah, it would be neat though if you could get like maybe a 3-man crew one game, especially like if it's Kip as a pitcher, you as a kid. So those are always the most interesting conversations. Pitchers and catchers, pitchers are strange, as you and I both know. But Kip's actually very, very smart and understanding of things. But pitchers and catchers, the conversations they have are so unique because it's almost like you're having that. It's almost like you're having that meeting on the mound during, you know, in the middle of an inning, but you're having it over the air.
Yeah.
People always wonder what goes into those conversations. But you, man, you did a great job. You really did. I'm so glad you're going to be on all three games this weekend. So that's going to be
the first two. I'm not sure about the third one.
Oh, okay.
But I mean, it makes sense to do the third one because I think Kip's going to be out of town all weekend and he wouldn't have been there for the first two. So, who knows? I'd be happy to do all three if they want me to, but I know I'm doing the first two.
All right, so this is your public pitch. Are you trying to get some momentum behind you? Like, do you need us to build this up for you publicly? Like,
I'm grateful to do whatever games they need me to fill in.
I'm sure your phone call to Coach Tanner will carry as much weight as mine will. So, but we're happy to make the call if you need
He'll probably fire me before that happens.
That's right. Well, at a minimum, he'll tell you what you're doing wrong before he tells you what you're doing right.
Exactly.
Well, that's good. So that creates a big problem for Phil and JC and myself, because I was telling Coach Lake the other day, look, dude, no offense, you know how much I love you and you know how much I love Derek, but Grayson was calling the game, so I kind of wanted to listen to him, and I did not listen to y'all in the air.
I got to see Coach Lake beforehand and asked him for some tips, and he's doing a great job. I love Coach Lake.
He's killing it. All right, so how about this Carolina baseball team here? So they're 21-7 and they're 5-4 in the league. Those five wins are great wins. Mm-hmm. I mean, you go on the road. It doesn't matter where you go. You go on the road, as Coach Tanner used to say, don't get swept on the road. And they haven't. They've salvaged. You'd like it to be a little bit more consistent than it's been. We'll get to that in a minute. Of course, they swept Vanderbilt at home 2 weekends ago. And you've got another number 3 coming in this weekend with Texas A&M. You get clearly Georgia Southern tomorrow night. But they're ranked in, depending on what poll you look at, they're in the top 25 of all of them. I think 22 in the D1 baseball poll. I think the word is consistency, though. That's what I'm looking for. I love the team.
Mm-hmm.
We know offensively what they're capable of. Defensively, they're getting better, but they can still have those moments. Although they've actually fielded it fairly cleanly, the exception of a couple bugaboos in the SEC. And then the pitching staff had a rough week, but I don't think that is going to be their identity moving forward. I think they just had a rough week. You have those. So here we are, 28 games in, right? You're halfway through your season. Where do you have them? What do you think about them?
It's just the grind of the SEC. Like you said, I mean, the major trend that we're seeing right now is nobody's winning on the road. I mean, it's I don't know, maybe this weekend might have changed those numbers, but I know going into last weekend, I mean, home teams were winning at a remarkable clip. And that's kind of par for the course in the SEC, but I feel like it's been magnified a little bit this year, and we're seeing it with the South Carolina team. But things could be, you know, 5-4, that's a good record at this point in the season. I mean, you're not going to, outside of a couple random years, I think Vanderbilt went like 27-2 one year when we were in college. But for the most part, your league winner is going to be in that low 20s range. I mean, you're not going to go undefeated in the SEC. So they're kind of riding the roller coaster right now, weather in the storm. The main thing that's kind of stuck out to me thus far is I remember Coach Tanner always saying, win the third game of the series, because you're either going to get the sweep, you're going to win the series, or you're going to avoid being swept. If you win that third game, if you go 10-0 on those third games, I mean, that's a big difference. And I think Carolina's 3-0 on those right now, right?
Yeah.
They won the third game to salvage against Ole Miss. Yep. They salvaged against Bama, and then they did the sweep against Vanderbilt. So if you can, obviously you'd like to win more than those 10 games, but if you can really buckle down and make sure you're avoiding getting swept on the road and you're winning series at home, you're going to find yourself in a good spot at the end of the year.
That old Coach Tanner, you know, he does know a little something here and there, doesn't he?
It used to be an easier saying to say win on Sundays, but now they do all the Thursday through Saturday. So we never had those when I was playing. So win on Sundays was always the go-to.
Stupid TV, you know, these damn TV games. It is a great point. And you know, Kentucky, Arkansas both sit atop each division at 8-1. Arkansas they're good, and they're coming to town in a couple weeks. We'll get
them. They might go 27-2.
Yeah, they're pretty good. Kentucky, you got to feel like at some point in time, I mean, they're swinging the sticks, man. I mean, they're killing the baseball, but they will hit at some point in time a stall or a wall as competition kind of ramps up too. But they've won on the road, as you pointed out. It's hard to do. Let's go back behind the plate, and let's talk about Cole. You don't Grayson, right? You don't get selected as a preseason first team All-American catcher for no reason at all. Like, it is hard to get that nod. And you've got to have done something really, really good. I think where he's come of, I remember a couple of years ago, I don't know how much you had a chance to see him as you were playing, but he was deer in the headlights his freshman year, swing all over the place. I mean, he just didn't have a lot of confidence. A lot of freshmen go through that. I'd say 9 out of 10 do. Last year, I think not only did he create such a storm offensively, but I think where I was most impressed with him was behind the plate, how he handled that staff and things of that nature. This year, he's had his scuffles at the plate. And I think we could agree on that. I think he'd be the first one to tell you he's probably striking out a little bit more than he needs to. Last weekend was the first time I felt like I saw him carry that over defensively. It just didn't look good back there. Body angle was bad. You know, just a lot of things. It just seemed a little bit out of sorts for him, and then he was able to kind of recoup it by the end of the weekend. So, I mean, you're a big league catcher, dude. You know more than all of us. Give us your thoughts on the first half of the year for South Carolina's leader, Cole Messina.
Yeah, I mean, those games are going to happen. I mean, I've had those games. Everybody's had those games. But the main thing you really don't want to see, especially at that position where you're involved in every single pitch, is to see it snowball. And luckily, we didn't see it snowball. You know, he had a couple huge hits on Saturday and helped lead the team to a win on Sunday. And he could have very easily, you know, he had a couple of balls that I'll tell you, he'll tell you that he probably should have kept in front. I mean, he's usually excellent at that. You know, we don't know the conditions there. They mentioned maybe the lighting was a little different than at home, but regardless, those are balls that he wants to keep in front, and he knows he could have kept in front, but it would have been very easy for him to let his guard down and kind of give the series away. And he locked in the next 2 days and played well, played like the All-American. So those are going to happen, but you kind of see him get mad. He's kind of got that bulldog mentality where, you know, sometimes can be a good thing, sometimes can be a bad thing at that position. But He's got that bulldog mentality where, you know, if he lets his teammates down, he's going to do everything in his power to make sure that doesn't happen again. And he's one of the one or two or three leaders on this team. And going forward, we're right at the halfway point of the season. Going forward, they're going to be relying on him on both sides of the ball. Whether it be at the plate or behind the plate, they're going to be relying on him to lead this team going forward to get them to the postseason.
Grayson, offensively, I mentioned the word inconsistent because Saturday, they swung it better, much better with runners on base. But man, then there's some games where they just look totally lost at the plate when there's guys anywhere out there on the pond. What does that come down to sometimes as a group when you're just getting a total funk like that?
I think it's sometimes going to be putting pressure on yourself. I mean, as much as guys say they don't hear or see what's going on around them or hear what people are saying, I'm sure it's somehow coming across their phones that they're struggling with runners in scoring position. And then you walk up from the on-deck circle and realize there's men on second and third and one out. Somewhere deep in your body or deep in your brain, you know that there's runners in scoring position. You got to get this job done. So whatever you can do to just, you know, kind of clear your mind, go up there as if there's nobody on base and not try and do too much or too much pressure on yourself. And it's easier said than done. I mean, you want to get the job done. You want to you're facing the best arms in the country day in and day out. So and it's contagious. I mean, if as a team you're struggling, you see that, it's harder to get it going. It's harder to be the guy that kind of reverses the trend. So that's more pressure added. So I think once you see, usually it's one game where one game everybody starts clicking and then you ride from there. So we'll see what happens. They did a good, I mean, Saturday, the first couple innings, that big guy for Alabama was just striking out everybody. And then at one point we started working some walks and getting some big hits. So I think Cole had the big double down the left field line that kind of flipped the game a little bit. But like I said, it's a contagious thing, and you feel it in the dugout. You can feel it as a coach. You can feel it as a player.
Speaking specifically to you right here, I want you to talk baseball to our audience.
Okay.
How do you approach an at bat, Grayson? You're walking into it's a 0-0 count, and then you go from there. But you know, I'm not going to ask you to go through every scenario, of course.
I need a lot more information than that.
You know, but when you're stepping, I had a guy. Do you know Johnny Cribb? Do you remember Johnny Cribb? Johnny caught at the Citadel. He was part of that group that went to Omaha, and he used to tell me one pitch, one spot when you're even or ahead, when you don't have a count or when you're ahead in the count, and mm-hmm. then you adjust from there. What was your approach? Not only at South Carolina, but throughout your career, when you got to the big leagues, how did you approach hitting?
Like I said, you'd have to give me more information. I was a big believer hitting to the situation. I mean, if it's 0-0 count, I'm leading off an inning.
Yeah,
I'm not swinging at the first pitch, trying not to, unless it's I'm looking for a fastball middle end that I can pull for damage. Because if you're a leadoff hitter, you don't want one pitch, one out. That just, you know, that makes the guy behind you have to take one or two pitches. So, but my general philosophy as I got to pro ball was I want to hit the fastball to right center, and that would hopefully keep me on time for a breaking ball if they hang it to be able to pull it. But when I would get in trouble is when I would think pull the fastball, because then you have no chance on anything else. And unfortunately, that happened a lot at South Carolina and a lot throughout my career. Your eyes get a little big. You get a 1-0 count. You think the guy's going to throw you a fastball, and you're not even close on anything on the outside part of the plate or a breaking ball. So as I got older, I tried as best as I could to just think fastball. I'm going right over the second baseman's head, and hopefully that gets me on time. The main philosophy you want to have is never miss the fastball, because there's very, very few good breaking ball or changeup hitters. I mean, it's just a fact. So I always heard, you know, good high school players that are going to go play D1, never miss the fastball. Good D1 players that want to go play pro, never miss the fastball. Good minor leaguers that want to play in the big leagues, never miss the fastball. So just having that approach to always, always be on the fastball.
Well, I teed you up. Actually, you answered it perfectly, because, I mean, duh. I mean, obviously, you're right. This one of the things that I felt like, JC, you and I would text you about this early in the year. And I kept feeling, I mentioned to Coach Lake, I was like, they're missing a lot of fastballs. This team was earlier in the year. They were missing a lot of fastballs, balls that they should hit. I feel like, although they had some struggles last weekend, certainly, as you mentioned, on the road, over the last 2+ weeks, especially the Vandy series, Presbyterian games like that, they're not missing the fastball like they were. Like, they have been able to tee that up and time that up, and that's kind of got them going. Would you feel the same way? Do you feel like there is a little bit of a difference now, maybe versus a month ago?
Are you asking me or JC?
No, I'm asking you. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I don't know anything about it, Grayson. That definitely wouldn't be asking me.
I want to hear JC's opinion on that.
I was like, hey, he hit ball good. Oh, good. Keep ball. Don't strike out. You know, I don't know anything about the ins and outs of it. I had my glory years when I was in sixth grade, and I went yard 6 times in the season for the West Side Dodgers, and I hung up the cleats after that.
Yeah. Just from a small sample size, obviously, now that they've asked me to call some of these games, I was watching kind of loosely. Like, I'd have it on at home with my kids, just watch. But now I'm kind of trying to tune in to make sure I know these guys pretty well. You're right. I mean, they're doing a better job of like picking out a couple guys. Petri, he doesn't hardly ever miss the fastball.
Yeah, right.
I mean, he's ready for it. But if they hang a breaking ball, he does a really good job of hitting that. But like I said, if a pitcher executes the breaking ball down and away, right on right slider to a righty, I don't know many guys that are taking that pitch and hitting it out to the opposite field. I mean, it's just a good pitch.
Smoke could. He'll tell you that.
Smoke could. Yeah, he's the best. But that's a rarity. So, I mean, they're doing a really good job. And correct me if I'm wrong. I know when I called the PC game at that time, they were leading the nation in walks. Yeah. If you can do that and hunt the fastball and make pitchers come to you with the fastball, if you have a really good approach and a good eye at the plate and get into some advantageous hitters counts, that's when you can really see some offensive success. But when you're getting quick innings where you're flailing at breaking balls early and you're not putting yourself in counts to get to the fastball, that's when hitting becomes hard, especially runners in scoring position. Pitchers are going to go to what? They're going to go to off-speed pitches. They're not going to give you a fastball.
No.
When I got to the big leagues, they were like, if you get a man on second base, you're not getting a fastball to hit unless you get to a 3-0, 3-1 count. And even then, you're probably not going to get a fastball to hit. So it's just that kind of goes back to, you know, some of those runners in scoring position numbers, which might be too geared up to the fastball. So who knows? There's so many ins and outs when it comes to offensive philosophy that it's, you know, it's got to be clicking all together.
Yeah, I mean, like your approach matters, and you know, and we could literally talk the ins and outs of these things all day, Grayson. I'm not going to take your time up all day, and frankly, a lot of people would be bored with it. It's like science to you and I. You know, it's like learning math. When you're first learning math when you're a little kid, you're all excited about it. You're happy.
Fans don't care about that. They just want to see the results.
They just want to see the ball leap. Yeah, exactly. And you're right about Petri. That was Petri's issue. Like Blake Cooper and I were talking, it felt like he was swinging underwater at times. And I was like, man, he's missing it. Like that's a ball last year that he was hammering, and then he got it right. And he certainly is. All right. So all that said, what do you think about the college strike zone right now?
I haven't watched enough to know. I will say that the guy, the umpire for the Presbyterian game, commented a little bit. I mean, it was kind of a blowout at one point. I think it was 17-6. And a lot of times in that situation, you'll see umpires change their zone because they want to go home. He did a pretty good job of staying disciplined, and I thought he had a pretty consistent strike zone. But then I was watching the Alabama series on TV, and it was – I mean, there were some bad calls. I mean, kudos to some of our players and some of the Alabama players on not showing up the umpires as bad as they could have, I suppose. Hitting's hard enough. I've always said, I mean, I never really liked to yell at umpires because I had to go work with them, you know, for 9 innings. But when I would get somewhat angry, I would just be like, man, that guy doesn't need any help. He's throwing 98 with a slider, and hitting's hard enough. He doesn't need 3 inches off the plate. So it's a big strike zone. It makes hitting that much harder.
Yeah. I mean, you see it from both sides as a catcher. Because, like, you know, they're using the TrackMan now, right? So these guys get dinged if they miss one here. And you'll get one day where nobody will give you anything on the black. So it's better right down the middle, or it's not a strike. And then you get one day where the next guy, he won't give you a high strike. And then you get one day where that guy's like, I've been calling it this way for 30 years and I'm not changing.
Yeah.
You know, so, but then as a catcher, like, you know, it's kind of like the old days, right, Grayson, where you didn't have track, man. You know, you nibble and you nibble and let's see how much I can get here before they actually call a ball. But then when you're hitting, you're like, that son of a bitch. Exactly.
I will say my last year playing, they were doing the challenge system in AAA, and I loved it. It was awesome. Do y'all know what that is?
No, I don't think.
Oh, it's the best. So umpire calls balls and strikes like normal, but each team gets three challenges per game, and it has to be player initiated immediately. So like a coach can't call and say, was that a strike? It has to be immediate. The pitcher, the batter, or the catcher can challenge, and all you do is top the top of your head. And immediately they show the track man on the big screen, so it's kind of suspenseful. They do like the ball flight coming in, whether it's going to be a ball or strike. And if you get it right, you keep your challenge. And if you miss it, you lose. That's one of your three challenges gone. You get three per game. So it's kind of a strategy, because if it's the top of the first inning and you're the leadoff hitter and you challenge a strike call and you miss it, now your team's down to two. So it's awesome, and it's very accurate, but it also still allows umpires to call games. But I'm sure there would have been some challenges this weekend in the Alabama series. Like, I think there was a strikeout to Cole that was really low. He immediately could have turned and done this, and they would have put it up on the video board with the ball coming in, and it would have been overturned, and he would have kept to the bat. So
wow,
it was really cool.
I think
it'll be in the big leagues probably within 3 years.
That's something I'm all right with. Like, I'm good with that. You know,
I also played the year before where it's all auto strike zone, and that was pretty rough. The umpires don't do anything.
Not okay with that.
They just have a Bluetooth in their ear saying ball or strike based off.
Yeah. Yeah. That's ridiculous. That's not baseball.
No.
Part of baseball is adjusting to each umpire.
The perfect mix is the challenge system.
All right. Well, as soon as we get Rob Manfred out of there, we'll put you up for commissioner, because that guy's, you know, he's something.
Yesterday they're doing the World Series as a neutral site starting in 2025. I didn't know if that was April Fool's joke or not. I think it might have been.
Oh, okay.
I got tricked like 200 times yesterday.
Damn, that's Bill, we should have had him on yesterday.
I saw somebody tweet that like Lenora Sellers got tore his ACL or something. I forgot.
Oh, no.
I was wondering how they could get worse with, you know, than the All-Star game winner gets to, you know, host first and get the four games of the three if it goes that long. But yeah, that would just be awful. That would be terrible.
God. Yeah. That would be awful.
Rotated around like the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
No.
Grayson, what are you looking for this week? We'll let you run on this note. What are you looking for this week? Obviously, you'll be up there tomorrow night. You'll be up there Friday. Hopefully, the rest of the weekend as well. You won't be up there tomorrow night. That's the SEC Network. Tomorrow night. Yeah, that's the SEC Network. Tomorrow
night. Come on, man.
Yeah, you got.
We only got 2 weeks left.
We need to get with King about these Wednesday games. That interrupts the bowling league.
I know. No kidding.
All right, but you will be up there on Friday night. But four home games this week. I know they're happy to be home.
Mm-hmm.
What is important for this team now at 21-7, Georgia Southern, A&M, third in the country, coming to town?
Yeah, I mean, you're playing at home. I think we're kind of reached the point where we're seeing the main pitching staff. I'm very impressed with Ty Good. I think he's phenomenal. He's kind of that seasoned veteran who you know is going to throw the ball over the plate and can – I mean, he's a Swiss Army knife. He can go one inning. He can go six innings. Who knows? So you can kind of have him at your disposal all weekend. Towards the end of the bullpen, you got Veach and Ganey. You feel good about those guys. And I just – that offense for A&M is something else. I mean, they got a bona fide top 10 overall pick with Montgomery. He's phenomenal. I think he's got like a 970 slugging percentage. Higher than most people's OPS. So being able to hold that team in check is going to be tough. They're very well coached. I played for Schlossnagel for Team USA, so I know him pretty well. Got a Zoom call with him tomorrow, so I'm excited to catch up with him. And
Neat. They're just,
they're very well coached. Yeah, I haven't talked to him in what year was that? 2013, 11 years. So I'm excited to talk to him. They're just very well coached. They have a lot of talent. They've got some good arms, so it's gonna be a challenge. But I mean, you look at the you look at Carolina's upcoming schedule, every weekend's a challenge. Everyone's in the top 15. So it's not like this is any different than playing Florida or Vandy or LSU or anybody. I mean, it's just, it's what you sign up for when you come play here, and should be a good crowd all 3 days. I know a lot of people are going to be balancing Coach Daly's team on Friday and hopefully Sunday with the baseball, but hopefully we can have a good Gamecock weekend and get some wins.
Yeah, maybe they can put it up on the scoreboard or something like that.
If not, I might be just streaming it on my phone off to the side.
Are you talking about the baseball game at Cleveland, in Cleveland? Or?
Yeah, that's right. No. The Guardians are playing at home.
Man, no. Tickets for this thing are ridiculous for the women's Final Four.
Really?
Get me ins are for one session, for one game's $370 for the whole thing. It starts at $800.
What the women's game has become in just even the last 2 years is just awesome. I mean, it's kind of captivating the nation a little bit.
Absolutely.
I haven't seen the numbers from last night's game, but I bet it's ridiculous.
That's a lot of storylines, man.
We talked about it for 15 minutes on JC and Morgan today, and that's a college football only podcast. I mean, you know, everywhere. Not anymore. I mean, I got asked about it last week on radio shows in Tuscaloosa and Nashville. So
it's awesome.
A phenomenon. Yeah. They'll look back at that like they used to look back at, like when they look back at the 90s, you look at Friends. They'll look back at the 2025s. Hey, Caitlin Clark.
That's right. She's something else.
Yeah, the we'll ask somebody to put that. There's got to be somebody at the ballpark who could figure out how to, at least between innings, put the game on or something like that. So we'll put Coach Lake on that. He seems to have enough pull around there. He can figure it out.
He runs the play.
For what it's worth, Gamecock fans, the last time they were at home in the SEC, it was number 3. This week, it's number 3, and the next team that walks in April 19th through the 21st is numero uno. I mean, if you claim to be a South Carolina baseball fan and none of that's good enough for you, turn in the card, I guess. Maybe find somewhere different. I mean, you got the best teams in the country 3 straight weeks walking in here. The Gamecocks need you. 82-42 should be the number announced every single day that they play. Grayson, thanks for all the time, brother. Always love having you on. And as I pointed out, and I know I speak for a lot of people, you did great. And you're only going to keep getting better up there. So look forward to hearing the call on Friday night.
Yep. Thank you guys for having me. We'll be on again soon, I'm sure.
Hey, okay. I want to make sure the ceilings were tall enough in there. I was about to say, I've been in that booth.
I don't want
to. You fit in there, okay, right?
Yeah, I don't want to discredit Dave, but we had to put him on some boxes because I thought we were going to do the little in the opening segment sitting down, and we had to bring in some couple boxes to stand on, so it worked out.
You'd have to do that for me too if I was standing there. So. Yeah,
he was awesome.
Yeah, it's not like Kip or Coach Lake up there with him or Coach Tanner.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's probably taller than Coach Tanner. So, sorry, Coach.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, man. See ya. There you go. Grayson Greiner joining us. Talk a little baseball as Carolina's got Georgia Southern coming to town tomorrow night. Good Georgia Southern team. And then Texas A&M, and then back on the road for 5 in a row in Charlotte against North Carolina next week at Florida, and in Charleston against the Citadel Bulldogs on Tuesday, April the 16th.
I was just reviewing some past clips of our show. John Strickland got some inside scoop from a dang country concert.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. Yeah,
yeah,
that's how having good sources work.
Offering Coach Atkins that suite when he
we have the best guest in the world. Yeah, we're like, these guys are all I was like, wow, he was here. So you're at a concert and you get some scoop. I was like, wow, that's I don't know why I wasn't more impressed with that when I heard it the first time as when you hear it the second time. It's impressive. So shout out Strickland, way to go! You made the YouTube short montage.
What is it, Phil? What is it in old school? I love you, Dad.
I love you, Dad.
Hey, Frank's dad showed up.
Yeah, I love you, Dad.
Love you, Dad.
No, that's how. I mean, you know, you shoot, JC. You know, we're. I get a lot of my information from it. Sure as hell ain't just picking up the phone and calling everybody. Right place, right time, right?
That's right.
Right. It just falls to the scoop. Just falls from the sky for some people.
You know? Scoop just falls from the sky.
Scoop.
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 That word drives me insane.
I know.
We'll try not to use it unless it's
a silly name. Like, what is it? It's like the old newspaper days.
Yeah, that wasn't intended at you, by the way, Sherbs.
No, I don't like it either. People have poisoned it through the years with me, but
right.
and everybody uses it, and it's like not like now. I wish my name, like the old school reporters, like you said, Phil, like their names were Scoop. Scoop
McDonald.
Scoop Henderson. Yeah, see?
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, man, with the Brooklyn Dodgers. I'm playing the New York Giants at the Polo Grounds today. Biff McDonald is on the mound. See? On time. Scoop
McDonald. It's funny how that reporter accent, like that whole affect just deteriorates into Chicago gangster for you, which I think is one of the best things. Like, yeah, see? Yeah. See?
He's
see
a dead cover? Man.
See? He's a dead that's man. Right. See? Shannon Daugherty's on her last leg. I just saw that come across.
Oh no,
that's sad. I like Melrose Place.
Yeah, I heard about that. Yeah, pretty sad. Pretty sad. All right, what's tomorrow? Oh, I think Morgan's back tomorrow.
Is he?
Oh, already?
Yeah, I think he's
around.
I haven't told you guys this. I have a doctor's appointment that I had to schedule today on Thursday.
Well,
I can't get it any other time. They're idiots. Or yeah. I have to wait till May.
Well, we got late night show tonight though too.
I could be dead.
Late night show tonight, 9 o'clock, right?
Late night show tonight, Matt Anderson. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe I'll see if we can get Matt for Thursday since the morgue will be on tomorrow.
Well, while we're dishing the hey, I haven't told you so. Hey, I forgot to tell you. I quit. Oh Jesus! well, I'm gonna be off Friday, so I got invited yesterday to go play out at the Ocean Course, and you can't really turn that down.
So speaking of Scoop and connections, you deserve to go play the Ocean Course. Me and Phil got it. We have a great time. I mean,
yeah, man,
we miss you a lot when you're gone.
I figure if the wind's blowing, I'll just. Use my 9-iron the whole time.
Oh, I've messed up. It was 90210. Jesus. Sorry.
Jeez. Sorry, Mr. 90s sitcom. I'm just kidding.
Was that a sitcom or more of a teeny?
I don't know. That wasn't really a sitcom. That was.
Was it? Yeah. All right. Anyway.
Yeah.
So, hey, well, yeah, that's good. Go play golf. Like I said.
Drama. There you go, Clint. I knew it was at the tip of my tongue. 90s drama series. Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks to Grayson Greiner and Hale, McGranahan for joining us. Thanks to Sherbert and Mad Dog and his mustache. And thanks to all of you. Yeah, BRC, I'm aware. I assure you.
Well, like I said, man,
I know what they do behind my back over here.
Y'all, you're not supposed to. I see y'all snitches in the chat box. Snitch.
Yeah, I know what they do.
Don't be snitching.
It's reflected in it's reflected in their paychecks. Don't worry. They pay for it.
Yeah, Clint says second cast member to Diana's right. Some one of the men, the dude that get Brendan.
That's right, Luke Perry.
Luke Perry, Dad. That was one of those like we've had a rash of celebrities die since 2016. After Harambe got shot, all hell broke loose, by the way. I want to remind everyone of that. But that was kind of an earlier one before like he got printed. I mean, that was kind of a, wasn't it? Maybe it wasn't. I don't know. I remember being kind of surprised because I thought he was really young. All started with Harambe. Never should have done it.
Harambe.
Think about it. Think about the world after pre-Harambe and after Harambe.
Yeah.
You're right. It important. Did kind of turn into
Harambe made me bet $50 on the Bengals in the AFC Championship game, the second one.
Yeah.
With Joe Burrow that they lost.
No.
I was sitting there trying to figure out who to pick. I was texting with Phil. I said, I saw this picture of Harambe. So go Cincinnati.
Putting it on Cincinnati.
Letting it ride.
All right. My final parting shot today. Happy birthday to Cam McCormick. Anybody know who Cam McCormick is?
The ninth year tight end.
Ninth year tight end at Miami. Years. He turns 26 today in his ninth year of college basketball or college football. All right, Cam, you go get him. People are like, dude, well, why is he still? What is he doing? I'm like, let me think. What was I doing when I was 26? Would I have liked to be playing college football on a full ride with some NIL money in Miami at 26? Hell yeah. Give me a 10th year if I can ruffle one out of there, out of the NCAA. Are you kidding me?
9 years.
Hats off to this guy. He's living the dream, dude. Jeez. It's not his fault. It's the system. They screwed it all up. Yeah, all right. Everybody have a terrific Tuesday. We'll see you tomorrow at 11 inside the Gamecocks, the show.